shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye not be troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet, for nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Welcome to the coming apocalypse. Analysis of today's headlines and how Bible prophecy is unfolding before your very eye. Please welcome now your host, Pastor Paul Bigley.
Well, thank you very much, Lee. Welcome, everyone. This is the coming apocalypse. I'm Pastor Paul Bigley, and I have not, well, I tell you, first of all, I was censored all morning by YouTube and would not let, it would say that I had posted a video three times, but it would not allow it to post. Okay, until I changed the title. I had to remove the word urgent. Once I removed the word urgent, it has to do with this asteroid that everybody's talking about, this asteroid WWF-9 that NASA once had on the screen and then removed it. And so there's people who, you know, there's all kinds of theories out there that this thing is going to get very close to the Earth on February 25th. I don't know. I'm going to ask Gil Brizard. That's one of the questions I'm going to ask Gil Brizard. And that's right, Gil Brizard is our guest today. So we're going to ask him, we have four serious questions. I'll tell you about that in a minute. But we've got a prophecy alert. Anyway, YouTube was allowing me to post my other videos, but would not let me post this video until I changed the headline. It never said that's what the problem was. It just wouldn't. Once I changed the headline, it posted. Blog Talk Radio gave me fits till the last 5 seconds. And then it finally said I could start the show. So I think Gil Brizard's appearance is certainly being monitored. There's no doubt about it. And so whatever he's got to say, matter of fact, he says he has breaking news for us, or a breaking revelation for us that he's going to share with us today. We're going to talk to him about four things. Planet 7X. We want an update on it. The comet 45P. The asteroid WF9, is it really an asteroid? Is it really going to go by February 25th, or is that just just a rumor out there? And we want to ask him about the revelation, the wonder in heaven that's found in Revelation chapter 12. What is his take on that coming into alignment? What is his take on that in September? And then he has a special breaking revelation he wants to share with us that's going to take place this spring. And so we'll find out what that is when Gil Brizard joins us. But before we get anywhere else, let's go to the word of the Lord. We're going to go to the book of Numbers, and we're actually going to go to chapter 19. This has to do with a prophecy alert taking place today on breaking news that a red heifer has been discovered in a dairy farm in Mexico. I've seen the picture of it. It is absolutely perfect. And it was not DNA manipulated to make it. It is born naturally, and it has no spot, no blemish, and is a perfect red heifer, which the Bible requires when dedicating the temple. Okay? And so, of course, with the talk with the third temple coming, this is incredible information. We're going to wait and see. They've already found one red heifer, you know, over in northeastern portion of America. But the heifer has to be at a certain age. And once that age passes, then you got to find another one. Okay, they have found one. It qualifies. It's in Mexico. We'll tell you more about that in just a moment. But right now, Max will read from the King James Version of the Bible. He will read Numbers chapter 19. Max?
Numbers 19. And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, This is the ordinance of the law which the Lord hath commanded, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring thee a red heifer without spot, wherein is no blemish, and upon which never came a yoke. And ye shall give her unto Eleazar the priest, that he may bring her forth without the camp, and one shall slay her before his face. And Eleazar the priest shall take of her blood with his finger, and sprinkle of her blood directly before the tabernacle of the congregation 7 times. And one shall burn the heifer in his sight, her skin and her flesh and her blood, with her dung shall he burn. And the priest shall take cedar wood and hyssop and scarlet and cast it into the midst of the burning of the heifer. And the priest shall wash his clothes, and he shall bathe his flesh in water, and afterward he shall come into the camp, and the priest shall be unclean until the even. And he that burneth her shall wash his clothes in water, and bathe his flesh in water, and shall be unclean until the even. And the man that is clean shall gather up the ashes of the heifer, and lay them up without the camp in a clean place. And it shall be kept for the congregation of the children of Israel for a water of separation. It is a purification for sin. And he that gathereth the ashes of the heifer shall wash his clothes, and be unclean until the even. And it shall be unto the children of Israel, and unto the stranger that sojourneth among them, for a statute for ever. He that toucheth the dead body of any man shall be unclean 7 days. He shall purify himself with it on the third day, and on the seventh day he shall be clean. But if he purify not himself the third day, then the seventh day he shall not be clean.
Huge!
Whosoever toucheth the dead body...
Time out! I mean, this. I know this is Old Testament. I know it's the book of Numbers. But the significance of the date. If a man touches a dead body, he is unclean for 7 days. But he must be clean, purify himself on the third day. Then on the seventh day, he shall be clean, basically, okay? But if he does not purify himself on the third day, then on the seventh day, he won't be clean. Now, folks, we know if you read the Bible, and I've said this many times to you guys, that the third day, if you read the Bible throughout the entire Bible, unbelievable stuff always would happen on the third day. It's in all over the Bible. We know for sure that Yeshua, that Jesus Christ, rose from the dead on the third day. That was the purification. So this is a shadow of things to come, just so you'll know, that Christ rose from the dead on the third day, so that all of us who raise in Christ in the end time on the seventh day, which is God's final day. Remember, Peter said, remember, be not ignorant of this one thing. One day is with the Lord 1,000 years and 1,000 years one day. Okay, remember that? So in other words, there are 7 pure days with God. There's really 7 days with God. We are in the closing of the sixth day. We've lost some time with the calendars that because we kept changing calendars, jumping around. The Hebrew calendar says this is the year 5777, okay? And of course, there's other calendars, different years. But at the bottom line is this, we are somewhere very close to the closing of a sixth day for humanity and the beginning of a seventh day, which would be the seventh day being the seventh millennium of time. So God is saying, you got to be born again. You've got to come clean through the third day resurrection of Christ so that you will be found worthy in the seventh day or the day of resurrection for mankind. All right? You got to be saved. If you're not saved, you will not raise in the likeness of Christ. You will not be a part of the first resurrection. For the Bible says, for the second death have no power over you. So this is an important thing that's going on here, because God is actually signifying that the dedication of the temple is and the ritual and the blood sacrifice and the red heifer and the purification and the baptisms going on here of the washing, all of these things in the Old Testament was bringing us to the revelation of the New Testament taking place right now. And we know that they're going to build the third temple, which is a prophetic fulfillment in the Bible of the end times. And so here we are on the brink of this thing, just unbelievably on the brink of this thing. Are you serious? We're on the edge of eternity. We're at the brink of the beast. We're at the prophetic time like never before. We're at the apocalyptic hour. Incredible stuff here. What? And you'll never hear, you rarely hear this taught or preached on, because folks will sometimes get emotional about it. But it's not hard for me to understand it. God put a plan in motion, and he's fulfilling it perfectly. And if you study the Old Testament, it can help you understand the New. And it's all about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's all about the Lord's return for the bride. It's really setting us up. And folks, these things are unbelievable. We're dealing with red heifers being born that are perfect. This one here, I've seen the picture of it. Perfect. Not one hair a different color. Not one blemish on this heifer. Perfect. And it can never have a yoke put on it. Okay? Could never have been trained by man at all. It has to be a pure DNA perfected heifer. And that was what was required in Exodus for the dedication of the temple. And obviously, so if you're hearing about the temple mount, the all of the utensils are already in place, ready to go. The temple's already prefab, ready to be brought in. I mean, the negotiations are going on. The nations are gathering around Jerusalem. I mean, you can't, you'd have to be absolutely spiritually blind to not understand you're living in the last days. Now, we don't know the day nor the hour, but my Lord have mercy. You can, we're in the fig tree generation. Listen to this. Israel was not a nation rebirthed, I should say, was not rebirthed as a nation until 1948. Unbelievable here. It's here. Oh, by the way, from the covenant of Abraham to the crucifixion of Christ, 1948 years. And from the crucifixion of Christ until Israel rebirthed as a nation, 1948. And it's been a nation coming up on the 69th anniversary. Which Trump may make the declaration he's moving the U.S. Embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem on May 14th or somewhere in late May. And that ain't the day he'll move it, but he may make the proclamation he's moving it, which is unreal because it's at the 69th, end of the 69th year. And if you go to Daniel and read about the 69 weeks, then you have the 7 days left or the 1 week left or the 1 year left if you look at it from this perspective, from Daniel's vision. So all the pieces and parts, you can't make this stuff up. You can't have these many pieces and parts prophetically coming together at the same exact time. It's just absolutely mathematically impossible unless God is orchestrating it. And I've been preaching the gospel for 33 years, coming up on my 33rd year, which I got to say something that's very prophetic about this year. Can I just say, are you ready to be blessed? The Lord reminded me this morning. He said, you do know what this is, don't you? And I said, well, what do you mean, Lord? What are you saying? What? You are in your 33rd year preaching the gospel. Christ died at age 33. Your new address that you just moved, you moved your mailing address, is Paul Begley Prophecy, 1048 Sagamore Parkway. That's Paul Begley Prophecy, 1048 Sagamore Parkway, Box 33. What? West Lafayette, Indiana. 47906. So the Lord says to me, you're in your 33rd year of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you're in your 7th year online. You're going to celebrate your 7th year on March 1st, and you're going to celebrate your 33rd year anniversary of preaching the gospel on June 24th. And it's happening in the same year. So then I'm saying, are you serious? God's saying, do you think these things are by accident? When I told you to get a cup of coffee and turn the camera on and look into the camera and visualize, at least 1,000 people would be watching you live online. At the time, folks, can I say to you, there was no live stream. YouTube did not even have live stream capability either. But the Lord gave me a word and said, look into the camera and visualize at least 1,000 people watching you live and speak to that. And I knew I was doing videos, but that was the word he gave me. It wasn't just now, it's just in the last 2 years that YouTube has had live capability, and the crowds of folks listening today will be way over 1,000. So every prophetic thing that God speaks, there's 1,098 already at YouTube now. Right now, we've already got the show. Gil Brazard is going to join us today. Steve Quayle will join us tomorrow. Mike from around the world will join us on Friday. We're going to try to get some answers to some explanations to the unknown. But first, go back to the heifer. I mean, are you serious? Are you serious? Max, are you serious?
And that is dead, and purifieth not himself, defileth the tabernacle of the Lord, and that soul shall be cut off from Israel, because the water of separation was not sprinkled upon him. He shall be unclean, his uncleanness is yet upon him. This is the law when a man dieth in a tent. All that come into the tent, and all that is in the tent, shall be unclean 7 days. And every open vessel which hath no covering bound upon it, is unclean. And whosoever toucheth one that is slain with a sword in the open fields, or a dead body, or a bone of a man, or a grave, shall be unclean 7 days. And for an unclean person, they shall take of the ashes of the burnt heifer, of purification for sin, and running water shall be put thereto in a vessel.
Unbelievable.
And a clean person shall take hyssop, and dip it in the water, and sprinkle it upon the tent, and upon all the vessels, and upon the persons that were there, and upon him that touched a bone, or one slain, or one dead, or a grave. And the clean person shall sprinkle upon the unclean on the third day.
Third day.
And on the seventh day. And on the seventh day he shall purify himself and wash his clothes, and bathe himself in water.
Right.
And shall be clean at even. But the man that shall be unclean, and shall not purify himself, that soul shall be cut off from among the congregation.
What?
Because he hath defiled the sanctuary of the Lord. The water of separation hath not been sprinkled upon him. He is unclean. And it shall be a perpetual statute unto them, that he that sprinkleth the water of separation shall wash his clothes, and he that toucheth the water of separation shall be unclean until even. And whatsoever the unclean person toucheth shall be unclean, and the soul that toucheth it shall be unclean until even.
All right, now, so God had a specific, absolute plan that must be carried out extraordinarily accurately. And that was to bring us to the pure DNA of Jesus Christ. We know this, okay? The cleansing, the cleansing, the cleansing, all of this leading us to eventually the virgin giving birth to the man-child. Man in flesh, God divine, the Son of the living God, in a barn, in the back parts of Bethlehem came this baby to set humanity free from sin. All of it coming together in the prophetic plan of God. Now, let's take a look. Hang with me, okay? Gilbert Zard's going to be here in a minute. Hold that thought a moment. We'll talk about the heifer in just a second. But let me tell you some other things that are going on around the world. As far as the earthquakes are concerned, yes, we have earthquakes. And let's just check them out the last 24 hours. 4.6 Japan, 3.2 Alaska, 4.4 Russia, 3.0 Oklahoma, 2.6 Puerto Rico, 3.9 Chile, 2.7 Puerto Rico, 4.7 Japan, 4.8 Ecuador, 4.7 Colombia, 3.5 British Virgin Islands, 2.6 Alaska, 2.7, 2.6 both in Hawaii, a 2.8 in Nevada, 2.8 Alaska, 2.7 Alaska, 5.1 earthquake in China, 4.9 New Zealand, 4.6 Peru, 2.9 Alaska, 4.4 Chile, 4.6 Peru, 3.3 Alaska, 2.6 Hawaii, 4.5 Tonga, 2.5 Cobb, California. That is the last 24 hours, the earthquake report, nothing major, with lots of pressure being applied to the earth right here, right now. I can tell you that the earth is under severe stress because the solar winds that are coming off the sun are at 600. They're still, yesterday they were 736,000 kilometers per second. Today they're 682,000 kilometers per second. With a gaping hole on the sun, a coronal hole in the sun's atmosphere, which is allowing a solar stream that's putting tons of pressure. The only thing I can figure right now is that full pressure from that hasn't completely reached the earth yet, because if it had, I would think there would have been a major quake. Hopefully, when it does, if there's hits in a spot where it's not as weak, or not one of the weak spots, or none of the tectonic plates are about ready to go. Let's hope not. We know the earth is just like so fragile right now. It's so fragile, but it is incredible what's going on right now around the world, in many different avenues. Gil Brazard, a very articulate astronomer, and nobody has studied Planet X and tied it to biblical, the historical accounts of major events that happened on the earth in the Bible, and then checked it with ancient historical effects of events that happened to the earth, and they matched one event after another. No one has really studied it any more than Gil Brazard. Now, some people, you know, just like a lot of folks, they attack people. Gil Brazard said by his best calculations, he really thought that Planet 7X, he calls it Planet 7X or Planet X, would have been in a full arrival and full impact on the Earth last year, March 26, 2016. He really felt that. But he said from the very beginning, but I don't know. I'm giving it an 8-year window somewhere between 2013 and 2021. And the reason he's doing that is because historically and biblically, every time there was a major event He calculated how long each time these events happened, and he took that and applied that same analogy to this event since the last one we've had. And it would have been landing somewhere in this 8-year period. So because of that, he continues to keep a close eye on the heavens. He continues to keep looking up, and he continues to wait to see what is going to develop, just like all the rest of us, okay? Now, quickly, grab some coffee. Everybody, grab coffee and calm down, all right? But let me tell you some other things that are going on. No, Gil Brizard is not John Bro. Poor John Bro. Everybody thinks that that Mike Around the World is John Bro. Some people think that BP Earthwatch is John Bro. Some people think Gil Brizard is John Bro. Poor John Bro. Everybody thinks everybody's John Bro. I can tell you I met John Bro. And I baptized John Bro. And Gil Brizard is not John Bro. Okay? All right. So, all right. Let me read on. All right. Praise God. Hey, here's something that took place. Last night, did you see the President of the United States, Donald J. Trump, doing what he said he was going to do again? He said if he's elected, he's the only presidential candidate in the history of this republic. Listen to this. The only candidate ever to say to the American people, here's a list of 10 judges, and if you elect me president of the United States, one of these 10 I will select to be the Supreme Court Justice of the United States. Nobody's ever done that. They've all promised you. I promise you, they'd say, if you elect me, I will take a conservative judge, and I'll put them over here. I'll find the best there is. Okay? And some cases, that's what they did. They did find conservative judges. Our times, we were told they were conservative, but they leaned left. Okay? Trump said, here's the 10 names. He did this in March last year and said, here they are. Study them. Check into them. Find out who they are. And because one of these 10, I'll pick. I promise you that. My promise. Last night, he fulfilled the promise again. He chose to be the next Supreme Court Justice. Once he's confirmed, Judge Neil Gorsuch from Colorado, an evangelical Christian that has conservative views. President Trump officially nominated the Honorable Judge Neil Gorsuch to the Supreme Court. Judge Gorsuch has served our country as a defender of the Constitution, a believer in the rule of law, and a champion of life. He is a pro-lifer 1,000% and will absolutely be worthy of Justice Scalia's seat. That is a quote from Donald Trump, President of the United States. Now, the Trump went on to say, the American people elected Donald Trump to fill this vacancy. Now it's time for the Democrats to stop playing politics and put the interests of the American people first. Okay, so Donald Trump has chosen, and already the crying. And I didn't see Chuck Schumer cry, but he might have. But you've already can hear the waning and the whining and the weeping of the wimpy resistors of freedom. Anyway, I think he just chose. I have to say, I believe that this is a good man to choose. Somebody's got to sit on that court. Just here's for those who say, well, I don't know, I've got to sit back and wait and see. For those for the doubters who are looking for the perfect man, you'll never find him, he or she. You'll never find anyone perfect. But think of it this way. Look yourself in the mirror and say, what if Hillary had won? Who would she have chosen? Would she have understood the definition of marriage? Would he or she understood the definition of life? Would they have cared about the rights of the unborn? Would they have cared about your rights? Or been more interested in the rights of those that are not citizens of the United States instead of those who are? Ask yourself that. Look in the mirror. Look in the mirror in the morning. When you take a long look in the mirror and ask yourself, wow, maybe we should be happy on who we just got chosen. All right, well, anyway, I'll just leave that there because I think as preachers, we've preached, God says life. And then finally, when you have someone who's willing to judge based on life, we got folks saying, well, I just don't know. And it's real, very, very simple. If you don't know the difference between whether or not a child should live or die, you have no business in the seat of authority at all in this nation. If you don't understand the definition of marriage is between a man and a woman, let me just go on record right now. If you can't figure that out, then why would I ask you to figure out my life and figure out the economy and figure out everything else that we need in this country if you can't figure that out? Okay? So can I get a big amen or a shout down or a oh me? Or so it is truly thankful. Oh, by the way, let's go here quickly and talk about, I want to welcome all of you that are here. Almost 900 of you at New Live Stream. God bless all of you. And God bless the 1,400 or so that are over at New YouTube. And also all of you that are listening on Blog Talk Radio. God bless all of you. You won't believe what I had to go through to get the Blog Talk Radio on. They were censoring me. They were messing with me. And I couldn't get the buttons to create the show till 5 seconds left. So God bless all 134 of you that are listening on the radio because you dialed the number 347-324-5208. Sounds like to me that by the way, YouTube censored me heavy today. They didn't say they were. They let my videos go up except the one about asteroid WF9. Twice they put it in suspension and held it. And I had to upload it a third time and change the title and take out the word urgent. When I took out the word urgent, they let it post. So what is it about this asteroid that YouTube is nervous about? What is this asteroid? Why did NASA put it on their chart and then later remove it? It's not on their near object. It's no longer on the chart. Asteroid WF9 was recognized by NASA as an asteroid that was about a half a mile wide and was coming close to the Earth. Not going to hit us, but was a near-Earth object. Why was it there and then removed and nowhere to be found? And you got some people saying it's because this thing is going to come dangerously close to the Earth. And they just don't want us, they don't want to talk about it. And that's why some of these rumors are, I don't know. I don't know if there's an asteroid up there or not. I don't know. I'm going to ask Gilbert Zard if he knows. I just know this. When NASA never gives a straight answer, never a straight answer. When they do something and then change it, it makes me freak out. And then when I try to upload a video just asking the question, I'm not saying it's doomsday. I'm just asking a question. Is this thing real? Is it really there? NASA said it was. They even named it 2016 WF9. Then why did they take it off the charts? Why did they ignore it? Why did they name Planet X in 1984? And then never speak about it again after 1992 until 2015 when the astronomers in Chile saw it in the constellation of Orion. And then NASA had to say, okay, yes, there is a planet out there in the constellation of Orion. We're going to call it planet number 9. Okay, so I'm just asking questions. Why would you do that and then take it away? Explain to us why you took it away, NASA. And that's what's going on in social media right now, on Facebook, on YouTube, on everywhere. They're just asking a question. Why did you take, if you took it away, you identified an asteroid. You told us it was a half a mile wide. And then it was going to come close to the Earth, wasn't going to hit us. And you named it 2016 WF9 back in October of last year. Why did you remove it from the charts? Where did it go all of a sudden? You know? Did it just go slip sliding away? Slip sliding away. They say the nearest asteroid that's coming, slip sliding away. I don't know. Just tell me where it went, okay? I'm just asking questions. Oh, and by the way, speaking about mysteries, where did things go? Where did the Chinese tycoon, he's worth $6 billion, and that's with a B, $6 billion, business tycoon Yingzhou Zhuanhu. I'm not saying it twice because my Chinese is not very good. But where did this guy go? The Chinese government or somebody, they said some officials came in and asked him to come with them, and he's never been seen since. And his family and everybody's wondering, where did this guy go? Now, a couple years ago, there were 5 very wealthy businessmen who actually disappeared off the face of the earth. Oh, by the way, this happens in Hong Kong. And then months later, about a year later, these 5 men were found in containment in Beijing, China, in the mainland. So, again, you're dealing with a communist nation, and even though Hong Kong is supposed to have its own autonomy to be a democracy kind of, they're still inside the nation of China. China is still a communist nation. And I guess at any time they may just come take you and take what you got, and that's just the way it is. And they may say they're going to do that because they are communists and they need to share with all the rest of the people. A lot like Bernie Sanders said he wanted to do if he was elected president. A super socialism, sort of like Venezuela. And we come very close to having a weekend of a Bernie, too. Anyway, wow. Don't know what happened to this guy. Pray for him. Don't know what happened to him. And I'm sure his family and everybody else wants to know what happened to him. The guy's worth $6 billion. He's gone. So there's some things there. It's just really disturbing. Gil Brazard to meet us soon. Brexit! Brexit! Read all about it! Britain's Brexit! Theresa May says they're going to leave the EU anyway. Brexit! Brexit! Read all about it! Okay, so Bart Begley at the Crusader Journal has an article called Britain's Brexit Bill Set to Clear First Legislative Hurdle. A law allowing Prime Minister Theresa May to trigger Britain's exit from the European Union is expected to clear its first legislative hurdle, paving the way for the government to launch divorce talks by the end of March. See, here's what happened. Theresa May, the people voted to get out of the EU last summer. And here we are almost a year later and the entanglements are everywhere, okay? Theresa May says, wow, we got to get out of these deals, all of this entanglements. Trump says, come to Washington. I'll tell you how to get out of it. So she shows up in Washington, spends a couple days, says, Trump's a wonderful man. I don't agree with everything he says, but he is a great man, and we are standing with the United States. She goes back home, and the next thing you know, they're going to be out of this thing by March. Okay? So I don't know what he told her. I don't know what how he knew how to unwind this thing, but it's going to unwind fast. And the bill could complete the legislative process by March 7th. May plans to begin exit negotiations with the EU by March 31st, starting a 2 years of talks that will define Britain's economic political future. In other words, they'll start breaking contractual agreements one after another over a two-year period as they are leaving the EU. In other words, it's finally going to start. And the United Kingdom, the people of the United Kingdom, God bless them, everyone. They stood up for what was right. They seen what was going on. Their nation was being slowly drained of its resources and picked apart and weakened under the European Union. And they saw this, they realized it, and they decided that they needed to vote to Brexit. All right? Gil Brazard is going to join us very soon. Extremely talented man. Who has a fresh new revelation for us, some new information, I should say, that he is going to share with us today. He's also, we're going to ask him about that missing asteroid. Where did it go, Gil? Where did it go? Did it even ever exist? And if it didn't, all NASA has to do is tell us, oops, we thought we saw something, but we didn't. But don't tell us you see an asteroid that's a half a mile wide, you give it a name, 2016 WF9, and then you pull it from the charts and never speak of it again, just like Planet X. So we're going to ask Gil Brazard, what is the deal with asteroid 2016 WF9? Due to go by the Earth February 25th, maybe, I guess. And then what about Planet 7X? Give us an update on it. Any new information? What's the story? And also, what about Revelation chapter 12, the wonder seen in heaven by John the Revelator? Can Gil give us some insight to this extraordinary constellation event that is supposed to take place, I understand, in September of 2017. And what about Comet 45P Honda? Has he got any information about that while we got him there? And oh, by the way, he said this to me on the phone. He said, I want to give you my take on the five waves of energy. So we're going to be asking Gil Brazard about that. And Gil, tell us, what is this new info you want to tell us? That's supposed to take place in March. Okay? So we're going to get all of that from Gil Brazard, Lord willing, in just a few minutes. Now, meanwhile, the United Nations Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, he is the Secretary General of the United Nations. He has made a decree. He says, The ban based on religion or ethnicity violates basic values, according to Secretary General Antonio Guterres. He says such a ban risks fueling terrorist propaganda. In other words, Donald Trump, your travel ban of these seven Muslim nations, that just might cause to make these radical Islamic mad. You'll get them upset and they'll do something. That's because you guys have been operating in what's called appeasement. You've been saying, please, please don't shoot us, don't hit us, don't bomb us. We'll let you in, just be nice. And they say, we'll be nice. We promise to be nice. Okay? We promise. And then they come and they form the sleeper cells and they prepare to blow up your airport like Belgium, blow up your airport like Turkey, murder your people at the concerts like France, run people over with a truck in France. Are you serious? Shoot people and blow their brains out in a nightclub like Orlando, murder them at a Christmas party, San Bernardino. Okay? Please, please. So what this guy is saying is Trump has just made all the radical Islamic terrorist murderers mad. So what? Thank you. If you're making a terrorist mad, you might be doing something right. And it isn't a religious ban, by the way. These seven nations were chosen by Barack Obama as the seven most dangerous nations by which terrorists could enter our country. That is the words of Barack Obama. That is the travel ban he signed in 2009. He started it with just Syria for 6 months, and he added the other six Muslim nations because of the instability that were going on there. Now, Trump might have been able to been a little bit, he could have maybe rolled it out a little more professional and gave a 72-hour notice so that people wouldn't freak out. Okay, maybe. But he didn't want to. He wanted to send a message to the world that I'm slamming the gates. I'm shutting the doors. Get a clue. We're changing this thing. That's the Trump style. And I know Chuck Schumer broke down in tears. I mean, he got very emotional. But he's an emotional man. And so after a while, they'll learn. You guys got coffee? Thank you. This is the time we're living in, folks. We are living in dangerous times. Oh, by the way, drastic times may require drastic measures, but let's talk about the red heifer. Brock, you have a picture of the red heifer, right? Are you serious? Now, I remember a couple years ago, there was a red heifer that was discovered on a dairy farm, I believe in Maryland, and I'm not positive of that, so don't hold me to it. But I do remember reporting on it. It was a perfect red heifer. This red heifer was found on a dairy farm in Baja, Mexico. And that is simply this. The red heifer, as you just heard the scripture, that's it. That's the red heifer right there. A rabbi went to this dairy farm in Mexico to buy some milk. And he saw this heifer. And he said, what? Are you serious? That is a pure red heifer. And he studied it, and there was no blotch, no blemish, not one hair on that heifer's body was any other color but that red that you see. An incredible, incredible, folks, and just an absolute incredible. If you go to my website at paulbegleyprophecy.com, Brock has it on the screen. And so this heifer could never have had a yoke put on it. So he asked the guy at the farm if this heifer ever had, and the guy said no. So in other words, and then the age of the heifer made the heifer qualified to be eligible for the dedication of the third temple, according to scripture in the book of Numbers chapter 19. Now, as I've said 1 million times before, the red heifer is representing how that Jesus Christ, Yeshua, was the sacrifice, the lamb without spot or blemish. He was the Passover lamb, okay, that Moses said that they had to, all the children of Israel were to eat the Passover lamb and to put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost and side mantle. That was when they were leaving the land of Egypt. The red heifer is also representing the purity of Christ, the perfection of Christ, and everything that needed to be done. And so the bottom line is this: each year that we is the potential of the beginning of the building of the third temple. You look around to see, and you find out there are things that are taking place either by God or by man getting prepared to do for the dedication of the third temple. Now, Apostle Paul told us, it's not the blood of bulls or lambs or bullocks. It's not the blood of an animal that brings redemption from sin, but the precious blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. But before Christ came, folks, God had an established a plan, a set of order to bring the children of Israel to the point to where Yeshua could be born into the world as the Lamb of God and could be sacrificed just outside the city gates of the eternal city of Jerusalem. And that process was extraordinary. Set of rules, set of requirements, and if you touched a dead body, you had to get purified. It took 7 days to be completely announced that you were clean, but on the third day you would have to be purified so that on the seventh day you would be considered clean, okay? And there was other things as well. So as they go forward here with what they're going to do, and your body is now the temple of the Holy Ghost. So this ordination, or I should say dedication of the temple, Solomon's temple, was a shadow, a foreshadow of things to come. When Solomon's temple was built, it was in representation to your body as the temple of God, and that one day when God dwelled inside Solomon's temple in the Holy of Holies, that this represented that one day God could dwell inside your temple in your heart, which holds the Holy of Holies, the Holy Ghost. And so these were a shadow of things to come. Also, the third day, the reason you had to be purified on the third day so that you could be pure on the seventh is Christ rose from the dead on the third day so that mankind could be clean on the seventh day of God. Because Peter said, remember, be not ignorant of this one thing, brethren. And I'm sure he meant sister as well. That one day with the Lord is 1,000 years and 1,000 years is a day. So in other words, the seventh day, God's perfect day, God's completion, humanity can be set free and be presented spotless, blameless, pure before God because we accepted his son who touched death and overcome it on the third day when Christ rose from the dead. And these were perfect illustrations. Unbelievable. It had to be carried out this way. So the reason this is important now is because they will build the third temple. And it is going to happen. Matter of fact, they just announced yesterday, I did a prophecy alert yesterday, on the half shekel. The Sanhedrin, for the first time in 2,000 years, has approved and is bringing back the temple tithe of the half shekel. It hasn't been done in 2,000 years. Why in the world is the Sanhedrin bringing it back? Because they're getting ready to dedicate the third temple. They're getting ready to build it. And when you go to Jerusalem, it is now on the lips of everyone. And it used to be when this third temple discussion was going on about 30 or 40 years ago, there were a lot of Jews saying, whoa, don't go there because, man, if we start talking third temple, you know, the Muslims and the surrounding nations are just going to come against us heavily. So let's not talk about it. Matter of fact, the lawmakers in the Knesset said, shh, let's not talk about this. We'll upset the world. Well, here we are now in the 50th year of the liberation of Jerusalem. And the 69th year of the establishment of Israel as a nation, that there is not only a talk of a third temple, but there's a temple institute in Jerusalem with the golden shewbread table, the golden altar, the seven silver trumpets, the high priest, the breastplate, everything according to Scripture, including the golden menorah that's sitting on Mount Zion, staring at the Temple Mount. There are rabbis everywhere pushing for it, including Rabbi Yehuda Glick, who was almost murdered, shot four times by a Palestinian terrorist, only to survive miraculously, now sits in the Knesset and just came to the inauguration of President Donald Trump representing the nation of Israel and the name of Jerusalem, by the way. So I don't think you can make this stuff up. I mean, we are living in the last days. And oh, by the way, while all these things are taking place, all these pieces are on the table of the coming of the Lord, the prophecies of the coming of the Lord, earthquakes, volcanoes, sinkholes, meteors, asteroids, extreme weather conditions, apocalyptic, sometimes cataclysmic events taking place on the earth at an extraordinary rate as the birthing pains of the coming of Jesus Christ are magnificently being played out before our very eyes. And then throw in a few archaeological finds, like maybe they found the Urim and the Thummim, Urim and Thummim. Or maybe, and they found a high priest button, and they have found the tablets with seven seals. They have found archaeological finds of the city of David, and even the seed, olive seeds, inside a storage bin in the city of David, which is what Haggai asked the question, is there not seed in the barn? Haggai 2:19, which doesn't even make any sense when you read the chapter. It's like, why is that verse there? And so anyway, there's so many things. I mean, are you serious? And even now, every time I go to Jerusalem, people ask me, would you keep an eye open for one of the two witnesses? And there's two witnesses in the Garden of Gethsemane right now. There's two olive trees. They're the only two trees in this nation of Israel that are over 2,000 years old. So they would have been in the Garden of Gethsemane as small twigs when Christ knelt on the rock of agony and prayed until sweat became great drops of blood. Father, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Those two olive trees are there, and they're big now. But they are two witnesses of that moment. And guess what? The Bible refers to the two witnesses that are coming in Revelation to the two olive trees. Oh, you can't make this stuff up. I mean, are you serious? And no, Stephen Bendenoonan and myself are not the two witnesses, by the way. Because when these guys show up, oh, we're still preaching Yeshua, believe me, but when they show up, water's going to turn blood red. Plagues are going to hit the earth. Fire will come from their mouth of the Holy Ghost. And they'll preach the soon coming Yeshua, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, and that his return is imminent, and they'll be hated by the whole world. Oh, my Lord have mercy. So the Sanhedrin that have approved the half shekel and are involved in different things of the approval of the third temple, they simply are fulfilling biblical prophecy by doing the things that lead up to the third temple. It's really what it is. They're just simply fulfilling prophecy, okay? And while they do that, it just shows you you're getting that ever closer. Gilbert Zard is going to join us in just a couple of minutes. We've got so much to talk to him about. It's really incredible. I mean, I could probably preach another hour just on this simple subject of the coming of the Lord. And Revelation chapter 11 is where you'll find the blueprints to the third temple. And you'll also find the two witnesses. That's because they're going to show up. I mean, once that third temple is built, it won't be long. I don't know when, I don't know how many years, I don't know how many months, I don't know how many days it takes before the two witnesses actually show up dressed in sackcloth, preaching the fire anointed gospel of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ as Yeshua. But I can say this, there's a revival going on. Messianic Jews are getting saved all over the world. They are becoming Messianic Jews. They are literally all over the world. And in Israel, it is just continuing. It's unbelievable what is taking place. And at the same time, revival is going to sweep the land for both Jews and Gentiles. And I believe it's the Joel 2 outpouring that in the last days, the Lord said, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And upon my handmaidens and servants, I will pour out my spirit, thus saith the Lord. And oh, by the way, what else will happen? Go there, Joel 2. Well, it won't just only be that, but I'm going to pour out the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. Matter of fact, here's what else will happen. When these things happen, when the holy, powerful revival comes and the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, there will be some physical manifestations. Here's what it says. And I also, upon the servants and handmaids in those days, will I pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders in the heaven. Is that what Gilbert Zard is going to talk to us about today? And in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke, and the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and in the remnant to whom the Lord hath called. Folks, it is this, I'm telling you, the table is being set, and you have a front row seat to end time Bible prophecy. the current world events that are happening today and how they relate to biblical prophecy, as we're in our seventh year online, is couldn't be coming together any more clear than they are right now. And when we come back, we're going to go find Mr. Gil Brizard and bring him to the table. All right? So don't go nowhere. Hang on. Hang on. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. It's incredible what the Lord shall do. How come I'm having trouble here? Oh, here we go. And so we'll be right back. Give us about 3 minutes, and we'll try to locate Gil Brizard and Planet 7X and all the other things that are taking place, his take on the waves of energy, his take on the comet 45P, his take on is there an asteroid 2016 WF9. And right now I can see that we're having an issue. Okay, it's coming. And I would thank God for everybody here and praise God. Hang on just 1 second. And we'll be right back in about 3 minutes with the next hour and Gil Brizard, okay?
The coming apocalypse. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousand thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. I beheld then because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake. I beheld even till the beast was slain and his body destroyed and given to the burning flames. As concerning the rest of the beast, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and time. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Welcome to the coming apocalypse, an analysis of today's headlines and how Bible prophecy is unfolding before your very eyes. Please welcome now your host, an anointed preacher, radio talk show host, prophetic teacher who travels globally and has a genuine love for people, your pastor and mine. Please welcome Pastor Paul Bailey.
Salvation Station. Salvation Station. Salvation Station.
All right, we're looking for Gil Brizard.
The person whom you're trying to reach is currently unavailable. Please leave a message after the beep.
What? Gil Brizard trying to reach you on Skype. I hope you're out there. All right, let's try something else real fast. Aha. And here he is, Gil Brizard.
Hello, Paul. How's it going?
Really good. You are live with us. Huge crowd of folks gathered. Great to have you on the show today, Gil.
Well, I'm happy to be back.
Great to have you. Wow. Everything's going on like you wouldn't believe, Gil. And, you know, there's so much happening around the world with different events. But today we're really interested. I mean, folks are really interested and very glad that you've come on to be with us. We appreciate you returning. You are the expert, folks. Gil Brizard is the expert. I would say as it relates to Planet 7X, as it relates to the research of biblical events and how they were tied to historical accounts, nobody has ever researched it and tied it together better than Gil Brizard, and then verified it with I think 12 or 13 different scientists or mathematicians to verify this. So he has really done a great job. You can find his Facebook page. We're going to keep putting your website up there and your Facebook page, Gil, so people can find out more about you. But Gil, let me ask you a couple questions. We've got about 4 or 5 questions, but one of them is this, just to get this off the table. There's circulating everywhere rumors of an asteroid that's supposed to come very close to the Earth February 25th. Now, the name of the asteroid, NASA named it. In October, they said they called it Asteroid 2016 WF9. That was the name NASA gave it. NASA has now removed it from its charts. They said it was a half a mile wide. It's now listed nowhere. Do you know anything about this asteroid or what's going on with it?
I'm afraid I don't. I haven't. That's the first I've heard of it. So I can't really make any comments on it because I don't have any info.
Okay, that's fair. That's fair. Then what about Comet 45P, Honda? Any info you can share with us on that?
Yeah, I've turned it on the software program that it it's built into the astronomy software now whenever they place it out. And it's definitely not our planet because it doesn't have the same orbit. It's not crossing Earth path twice. Remember, Revelation and other parts tell us that this object that's in the biblical records crossed our path twice with a gap of 5 months in between the entry and the exit point.
Okay.
And because all the other items pivot from the center of the sun, so you have 3 fixed points. You have 2 where it crosses Earth path and 1 the center of the sun. So it gives you 3 fixed points. That places it on the ecliptic only. Okay.
Are we talking planet 7X?
Yes.
Okay.
So these other ones, these asteroids, remember their orbits are warped. That's the reason why we see so many asteroids entering our atmosphere, and also the reason why NASA is so worried. Because our planet 7X is warping the orbits of comets. We have scientific studies going back almost 7 to 10 years from the UK as well as the US that it proves out that the orbits of our comets are warped by unknown gravity.
So when you say warped, you're saying that the unknown gravity is knocking the asteroids off their orbit? Is that what you mean by warped?
It's kind of like you're on a 4-lane driving and you want to pass a vehicle, you cross into the other lane to pass around, and then you come back into your normal route, your normal lane. Well, it's the same thing with these asteroids. Their gravity is warping and bending their normal path. Okay.
Wow.
And that can be calculated and seen through instruments missing space. And from 2 scientific reports we have, and this is in the same area of space, Sagittarius, which is south of the universe.
Okay.
Remember, people, south of the universe is not polar south. That's called Nadar. South of the universe is where Sagittarius is.
Okay.
All of the data that we have, actually hard data, points to Sagittarius.
So is Planet X coming from the direction of Sagittarius?
That's its original course, right? Right now, if it was to reach us at, let's say, March of this coming up March, that means it's already on the inside of our solar system. It would take 76 days for it to cross, to enter our inner solar system and to exit. Basically, that's on the inside of Earth's path, let's say, around the sun. No one's seen it yet. The 40-day mark, which is very interesting also. Remember Jonah, when he warned Nineveh, gave him a 40-day warning.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I just received some information that Trump generals are sending over 5,000 troops into Iraq. and that they should be finished with ISIS in Iraq around February 4th, where they'll be announcing that they're free of ISIS as far as Miss Iraq.
Wow.
And that Nineveh, you know, is free.
Well, now, wait a minute. So you're saying we just got breaking news just now that Donald Trump is sending 5,000 U.S. troops into Iraq to eliminate ISIS and to try to have them completely wiped out of the Iraq, at least out of Iraq, not Syria, but Iraq, by February 4th.
That's what I got that over a week ago. And it's in the paper that he sent five. I've heard over that number. They're leaving Kuwait. They drove across the country and they're helping them. And they should be finished fairly quick. And then after that, then they'll probably go into Syria and finish up ISIS.
All right. So we'll just keep that information and watch that close. I do know, personally, we know from our online church, I can just say we've had a lot of mothers contact us and ladies saying, pray for my sons and pray for my husbands. They've been sent to Kuwait. And we've had some even say, pray for my sons. He's been sent to Iraq. So we've been hearing that. I've never spoken a word about it publicly. But since you're bringing this up, I'll just say that is one thing I know. I don't know anything about the 5,000 that the president is sending. But I know this. The president of the United States definitely has made no bones about it, that his plan is to annihilate and eradicate ISIS from the face of the earth. He said it in the inaugural address. So, I mean, we shouldn't be shocked when we hear of a plan going into effect.
Right. What is interesting, keep in mind, Mosul is the old town of Nineveh.
Right.
I'd already made the claims that 40 days, if it is going to show up in March, which I don't have a crystal ball, I can't tell the future. I'm just saying for us to pay attention, like watchmen of the wall. We have a very interesting lineup that takes place March 15, 16, which lines up with what the biblical is saying on Revelation 12, 1. Counting backwards from that, the 40th day is February 4th.
Wow. Okay.
So maybe there's some kind of parallel with the Bible there. If it occurs, that we have yet to find out if it happens.
So let's talk about your March. So this is the breaking news that you're sharing with us today is, you're saying that it's very possible. Again, you don't have a crystal ball. You're not guaranteeing it. So when people, please, if it doesn't happen, he isn't guaranteeing it. But Gil has studied enough to know that he's in the ballpark. He has studied how many times that we've had these major biblical and historical events. And I'm talking from the days of the sign that Jonah saw, the sign, the preaching of Jonah, that in 40 days the Lord is going to destroy the city. And this happened the same time that the planet that it's believed that maybe the planet 7X went by. Also, Hezekiah's sundial going back 10 steps or 10 degrees. And there's other accounts. So based on this, Gil has come up with an 8-year window unless you've adjusted that. It was 2013 to 2021. So are you saying, Gil, that this March, what days are you thinking planet 7X is going to go by?
Well, it's not exactly thinking now. What I'm saying is when we look at the astronomy software, we have a lineup.
Okay.
Revelation 12:1 clearly tells us, okay, it says the moon at the foot of the woman. All right?
Okay.
Well, if it says moon, where do we look? We look in the sky. All right?
Okay.
And the woman is talking about is Virgo. Well, when we take a look at the software, we know that Elijah is supposed to come back around Passover or on Passover. That's usually either March or April even.
Okay.
Also, the biblical records tells us that sometime it causes seasonal changes.
All right.
It causes either severe droughts or early winter or late winter, something like that. Our seasons end up being changed because of this.
Extreme weather conditions, changing almost like seasons. The other day it was 64 degrees here in mid-January. It felt like mid-May. I mean, it literally looked like mid-May. It felt like mid-May. I'm thinking, wow, is there something going on here, you know?
Right. Today, where I'm at, I'm at 75 degrees over here, you know? So the AC is coming on.
Yeah.
And it's middle of winter. So right. We definitely have changing parts of our weather and seasonal changes globally.
So are you saying that this one, let me just read a little bit of it. It's Revelation 12. The Bible says, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she being with child cried, travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Are you saying that this wonder in heaven is about to happen in March of this year?
What I am saying is that we have a lineup that we need to pay attention to.
Okay.
If it does happen, then we are awake. We're not asleep.
Okay.
Okay. So be a watchman and pay attention, see if there's any other clues that show up. Remember, the UN voted against Israel. That's biblical also. That was predicted over 2,000 years ago.
Yes, it was.
All right. So that happened just a few months ago. 2017 could be a very interesting year, starting again with this lineup. The word dragon in there was a common word used throughout time representing a comet. Okay?
Okay.
If you read closely, it says Virgo is the only constellation illuminated there. All right.
Okay.
The word Helios in Greek can mean multiple items. It can be a sun. It could be a comet. It could be a star. It could be anything that's illuminated.
Okay.
That's
okay.
What the word actually means.
Okay. Okay. I got it.
So you have, and she's pregnant. Well, the king planet was the same planet or star, if you wish, because it from Earth it appears as a star. Was the same star that showed up for the birth of Mr. Yeshua. Well, March 15, 16, it's in the belly of Virgo.
The star.
Yes, exactly. Basically at her belly button where she would be pregnant.
Ready to be delivered.
Right. And so the Bible talks about also that daylight has made it to night and night into daylight. Well, that's not an eclipse. Eclipse cannot bring you light into the night part of the sky. That is a 12-hour delay it's talking about. For midnight to be noon and noon into midnight, that's a 12-hour delay. Just like the time of Joshua's long day, he had 12 extra hours of daylight. Well, the opposite side of Earth at the time would have 12 extra hours of darkness. This is going to reoccur when this planet comes around.
So
now
this womb of the woman of Virgo, there is going to be the star. There's a star, a bright illuminating star, you're saying around March 15th or 16th, that's going to pass into the womb. We're going to be actually, because a lot of folks were hearing September 23rd, 2017. Is that wrong? Are they talking about something else?
It's my strong opinion. Yes, that is a misinterpretation of the way the Hebrews use the sky.
Okay.
The occult version, which is called the Zodiac, is using the daytime skies. They use charts, and now today they use software, because you can't see the stars during the day. And these people are turning off the sun. There's a setting. You can turn off the sun in the software, to where it looks like it's night, but it's the daytime sky. In September, you're looking at the daytime skies at Virgo. In March, you're looking at the night. That's why they're 6 months apart.
Okay.
All right? Because one, you're looking from the daytime. The other one, you're looking from the nighttime at Virgo, the constellation Virgo. The Mezarah, which is what the Hebrew used throughout the scriptures, was the nighttime skies where anybody can see the sign. Remember where it says that our Messiah returns mid of night, not mid of day.
Okay.
right?
Right.
Remember where the 10 virgins are having mass? They're lit.
At midnight.
Right. It's not during noon, is it?
No, it's midnight.
Right. And this is after a 12-hour delay in Earth's rotation.
Okay, okay. So okay. So the September 23rd is a daytime constellational alignment, and you're saying that's opposite of this March 15th or 16th, which is a nighttime constellation alignment, which you believe, and what the point you're making here is, fits more the biblical narrative of the coming of the Lord at midnight. You're literally looking at it from the point of view of where the constellation alignment is taking place.
Correct. And I also calculate in there that there's a 12-hour delay. Okay. Because this is viewed from Jerusalem at mid of night. So when you slow down Earth's rotation by 12 hours.
Okay.
And when you go, this is the point that I missed in 2016.
Okay.
When we go back and look at Joshua's long day, it says the moon was delayed by 12 hours as well.
Ah.
So when we come back and we delay the moon by 12 hours on 15-6, it puts it exactly at her foot.
Okay.
As the text is stating.
So now, you're saying the Revelation 12 wonder in heaven, that a lot of folks think it's in September, you're saying, hold on a minute. In reality, it's really going to happen in March. And that there's also something coming into the womb that's going to be illuminated. And you're saying it's a star. Do you know what it is? I mean, have you identified it? Is it a comet? Is it?
No, it's Jupiter. It's Jupiter. It's the king planet.
It's Jupiter.
The king
okay.
Moved into the belly of Virgo.
Okay. And that we know is going to happen. That is absolutely a fact, folks. It's going to happen.
Yes. She okay. is giving birth to a king.
I got it.
That's why it's the king planet.
Okay.
And read the text carefully. It says only Virgo is illuminated. You can't do that with the sun, but you can do it with a comet's tail, because the tail points opposite of the sun, and the software model shows us that only Virgo is illuminated. Now, keep in mind that Jupiter has an orbit of 11.8 years.
All right.
It would not come back into Virgo's belly till another 11.8 years. Now, how do we make that line up with the Hebrew counting method?
All right. Help me on
that. They have 7 years, you know, every 7th year is a Sabbath year, and every 50th year is a Jubilee.
That's right.
Well, this is this is when he picks up his bride, and the bridemaid brings them to a place of safety in the wilderness, where they prepare for a wedding and trained. They have to be, you know, they have to learn a song before entering. They have to learn. So that takes 3.5 years by the end of the wilderness, being trained and learning what they need to do for the wedding, which is 3.5 years later. Remember, Elijah and Moses show up at Passover alive again. We're going to see some real people. They are prophesizing for 1,260 days. Then they're dead.
Then they raise from the dead.
When the second taking away happens. But this one is to heaven. It says the dead are first, then the living.
I hear you. That's exactly what it says, folks.
And you can be anywhere in the world, and you're going to heaven. That's the second. But the first one is defined completely different. We read it carefully. You say the first taking away says a remnant. That's not everybody. You have to be in Jerusalem because you're following a mekrah. A mekrah in Hebrew means dry rehearsal. You're required to be in Jerusalem. That's why this sign is mid of night from the point of view of Jerusalem. Remember, the Messiah comes mid of night. He shows up in Jerusalem.
Absolutely.
Where does Elijah show up 3.5 days earlier than that? He shows up at Passover. Now, how did they know 2,000 years ago that this sign in heaven, which could land on any day as long as the stars are lining up, how did they know that this was exactly 3.5 days after Passover? Because 3.5 days prior to this is a full moon. Okay, how did they know this?
So you're saying this, I just haven't looked. I don't have the calendar in front of me. Passover this year is what?
It might be early.
Because that depends on the moon. We have to have two witnesses, and we have to have two priests. Have to look up and say, yep, there it is, full moon. Am I right?
Well, also with this, it takes, you have to have the right barley. The barley has to be, it's called a
the barley.
It has to be, Yeah, because you can't use the previous grain. You have to use that year grain because that's why you're thanking him for. You're thanking him for this.
The barley harvest.
Right, exactly. So.
So you're saying Passover. So we're trying to figure out Passover based on the barley harvest, based on the full moon, confirmed by two priests, and 3.5 days later, then you have this event that's in the heavens.
Which is exactly the same amount of time that the two prophets lay dead. Remember, they prophesied. I mean, the word profess means to speak.
Yes.
They can't speak if they're dead, so they prophesied 1,260 days. Then they're dead for 3.5.
Okay.
So, which is 3.5 days longer there on earth than the people who are in the wilderness for 1,260 days. So that actually tells you that they're at Passover, but the bride and bridesmaid doesn't get taken to the wilderness until 3.5 days later, which is on this day, March 15, 16, where this lineup happens.
So the lineup that we're reading here, this wonder in heaven that John the Revelator, a 94-year-old apostle exiled on the Isle of Patmos off the coast of Greece, is getting this revelation from Jesus Christ, and he sees a wonder in heaven. This event he sees of the star alignment is going to happen March 15th or 16th.
Now, keep in mind, a wedding, because you have to feed your guests at a wedding, you cannot feed them on a Sabbath or a Jubilee because you're conserving food on those years. All right?
Okay.
So it can only be the following March, which March or April. You know, it would be the Passover, which would be when it would occur. Well, we're looking for sometime in the future, let's say, the following March after Sabbath or a Jubilee in the next 50 years. Does this line up again? We have no lineups that ever occur. This is the only one that occurs on a Passover right after Jubilee.
That's, you know? In other words, we're not going to get to see this constellational lineup again. This is it?
This is it. For at least I checked the next 50 years. There is no lineup after the following March of a Sabbath or a Jubilee. Now, remember where it says in the Bible, all will be fulfilled before this generation dies out. That's all Israel form. They're already 84 years old, if you count in the Hebrew way of counting. They can't go another 50 years. They're all dead. This generation will have died out.
I know. And there's been, and just so that you know, Gil, I know you know, but so that the listeners out there will know, because that there are a lot of different starting points that different theologians and Bible scholars of eschatology, when you start talking about the fig tree generation, we call it, when does it start? Well, some people say, well, at the Balfour Declaration of 1917. Some say, no, it was when the United Nations voted and made Israel a state, actually on November 29th, 1947. Others say, no, it was when Israel became a nation on May the 14th, 1948. Others say, no, it's when Jerusalem was unified during the Six-Day War in 1967. So, and then you have the debate, is a generation 40 years? Is a generation 70 years? Is a generation 80 years? Or some would say, is a generation the man's allotted days that God told Moses 120 years? So where do you start? Where does it end? That is still up for debate. But either way, no matter where you start or end, we're in this generational period somewhere. I mean, Gil, wouldn't you agree?
Without a doubt. But I would just suggest people view the Bible from a point of view that is Hebraic.
Of course.
In its nature.
Of course.
Because that's who the authors were.
Of course. I agree with you 1,000%. So that's why you're adamant about the Hebrew calendar and following also the constellations. And I also know you follow the current events that are related. For instance, you just brought up Donald Trump, the potential fact that he may go in and take Mosul back from ISIS, fully liberating it, which was the ancient city of Nineveh. I mean, that's huge, especially if it ties into your dates prior to this March 15th, 16th. So you're saying sometime around February 4th.
Well, unless we get the reason why the timing is not pulled out of nowhere. We're using this mark in the sky.
Right.
And it says that we won't be asleep. That means if you're looking for it, because he's trained you to look at the sky for the moon, for the calendar. He's given us a sign in Revelation. He's trained us. That's what McRaws are and everything. They're dry rehearsals, and he's telling us how to tell the calendar. He didn't say look at the Gregorian calendar.
No.
He wasn't even there yet.
No.
He uses the skies So it gets you used to looking at the skies for signs.
Okay.
And since I cannot tell a future, I can only say it greatly concerns me. Pay attention to what's happening on the news and pay attention to what's happening in the skies. These next, until March 15th, if we don't see anything, then I don't see any other signs that would line up, that would match the biblical record. And
unless this event that we're looking at, this wonder in the heavens, even though it would be let's say, happening, what will take place during that, unless we're missing something that needs to happen yet, and that this is just the wonder in heaven during this fig tree generation. I mean, you have to know that, yeah. you know it's not going to line up. These stars won't line up like this again. That you know.
Yeah, I think that there's a parallel to something that he said. He said for a wicked and adulterous generation, there'll be one sign, the sign of Jonah.
Yeah.
I think that we do have a world that's wicked and adulterous, and if this is a double innuendo, that because there's two signs for Jonah. One was the whale, the other one was not. I think both the pages of Jonah are pertaining to the return of the Messiah. The first one was when he was going to be resurrected.
Yep.
And the second one about the 40 days is an indication, was the warning to the wicked also, that this is going to be coming next. Now, if we're right, then that means we're only going to have a short warning.
Right. Well, you know,
otherwise, telescopes would have given us advance warning of 16 years from the edge of our solar system. And I'm talking about amateur astronomers have been able to warn us 16 years ahead of time.
Okay. So
because, but we know it's close because the orbits of comets are warped. Our seasons are changed. Our magnetic north is moving at 12 times its normal rate. The tilt of the Earth has another 4 degrees tilt to it because it wobbles.
Yeah, okay? It does. Yep.
All these changes are not done by cars. No. Warming up the atmosphere. It doesn't affect the sun. The sun is acting extremely strange.
Right. You are right.
All the planets are warming up.
Yes, you are right.
And the orbits of normal asteroids are being warped, and now they're crossing Earth's path. And that's why we're seeing more and more meteors entering our atmosphere, because they are perturbed. They're
being warped
from the normal path.
So, okay, so you're saying, and you know what? This is fascinating, folks, seriously, because Gil is bringing forth everything that we're already hearing. We're hearing of the magnetosphere being moved. And Gil, I don't know if you've seen BP Earthwatch's video where it literally shows an incredible movement in the magnetosphere. We also, Dutch Sense, who captured it also. And now there's even some international organizations that have confirmed this. And Mike from around the world also talks about the waves of energy. So I want to ask you, what is your take? We'll come back to this. March 5th, write it down, folks, March 15th and 16th. Can we, before I ask you about waves of energy, can we be able to look up in the heavens and see this constellation of wonder in the heavens? Can we look up there and see it on March 15th or 16th?
Yes, at midnight.
It'll be
right in the center of the skies looking south.
Okay. Then at midnight, which time? Jerusalem midnight? Where?
Well, remember, if this planet approaches, we will, about 3.5 days earlier than that,
we'll see it.
Earth is too close to the plasma tail. They'll have to turn off the generators globally. So Passover is going to be held with oil lamps and candles because there'll be no power that night. So the world is not going to be, there will be no TV crews or radio crews announcing Elijah and Moses has arrived in Jerusalem. This is going to be a private meeting because there won't be power on the Earth. They're going to have to shut down the power plant because Earth is too close to the plasma there. It's like an EMP wave.
So saying there's going to be a global mass blackout, not because of mankind, but because of the plasma tail will be just too close. It will affect us.
Right. For about 3 days, we'll have that.
Wow! And oh, by the way, folks, we've had 3 days of darkness before. It was one of the plagues of Egypt. We've had this before.
And,
Okay. All right. So all right. Now let me ask you a question. Let's hold that for a moment. Let's just put that right there. I want to welcome all of you that are here. This is Gil Brizard, an astronomer. If you're watching at my website, my son keeps putting his website up on the screen, his Facebook page. He also has a DVD out, folks. Is that your website where that's available, Gil? I think it's planetx.org or something.
Net.
Okay. PlanetX.
It's
planet7x.net. Planet7x.net. You can go there, and he has a DVD. It's an excellent film they put together. That's where you could purchase that if you wanted to watch that from home. And get a whole, he's got all the charts and graphs. All this stuff is available. Check out his website, planet7x.net. Now, also, folks, Gil is from Louisiana. He's from Louisiana. And he really has dedicated his life to trying to help understand the signs in the heavens. And the Bible says that men's hearts would fail them, Gil, for fear, for looking after those things that are coming on the earth. So I want to ask you about the five waves of energy that Mike from around the world has introduced to us really about 4 to 5 years ago. What is your take on the five waves of energy?
Well, I have a different take than what they – I read the article where they said that quadruple, explode, and light years away. And this is the energy that's finally reaching us, hitting Earth.
That's NASA. That's what NASA says.
Yeah, I'm not buying that.
Okay, okay.
If it would be 50 million light years away, it would be a lot bigger than quadruple supernova. It'd be like 1,000 times greater.
Okay.
You'd have a nice star in the sky, like some sort of nebula, that would be extremely huge. Which to me is just missing impossible because the light and the plasma would dissipate by the time it reached here. If we're talking about a distance of 50 million light years away, and I have something that's quite a little bit more simpler and probably more practical. I promise. If a person uses something that's called Occam's razor, when you have two different opinions and one is simpler than the other, go with the simpler.
Well, when you're talking to Pastor Paul Begley, please go simpler, okay? Because simple, all right?
We have a model. We have the orbital path.
Okay.
We have also a given date in Revelation 12:1.
Yes.
Okay. The orbital path was given to us by the Asian astronomers. The Chinese, Korean, and Japanese, because they saw it for 26 months, they documented it. And each kingdom had at least 10 astronomers working for the royal houses. So that's at least 30 astronomers that saw it for the Asians.
Now that was China, Japan, and what's the other one?
Korea,
okay.
And when we plotted the information, I was the first to plot the information.
Yes, you were.
It gave us an orbit with an entry and exit of about roughly 150 to 152 days separation. Okay. That gave us the 5 months, and this object was on Earth's planetary plane. It crosses Earth's path twice.
Yes.
Well, so we have its highway that it's passing on and driving on, all right?
All right.
And it's elliptical. Now, we have a given date that Revelation is talking about, possibly, March 15th. So when we reverse the model from that point, and we go back to the point that NASA was talking about, that that they saw a light in the sky. That was December 27, 2004. What's interesting is Pluto was very close to our planet, and it was downstream of the tail. Well, if you remember when that little comet passed by, I think it was Mars, and it lit up Mars. I sent you some pictures of it.
Yes, I do.
Okay, that was a plasma discharge. Well, and that was from a small little rock in the sky that did that to Mars. Now we're looking at a planet that's 14 times or so larger than Pluto. I think there was a discharge against Pluto of massive proportions.
Wow.
And that flash radiated towards this Earth, and what's interesting, the position of Earth in December, where the moon, because it said it bounced off the moon, hitting our atmosphere, lighting us up at night. That's exactly what you see in the model. You have an exact replication of what they're talking about.
So do you know that when you just said that this event happened December 27th, 2004, you do know that the day before that, December 26th, 2004, is the mega earthquake of 9.1 or 9.2 in Indonesia that brought a tsunami that killed 250,000 people. Did this event bring that earthquake and tsunami?
It's possible. I can't rule it out, but
that's fascinating.
You're going to have different waves of energy, different types of energy.
Okay.
So, and it will affect the Earth in different ways.
Okay.
Now, some of this energy went further out into space. And because of the Voyager and Pioneer probes, we know that space gets thicker after a certain area. So these waves, when it hits space that's thicker, would have focused back towards the sun. It's like hitting a parabolic mirror, kind of. It would have focused it back towards the sun. Because Earth is kind of like in a fish, consider it in a sphere, like a fishbowl, that we have these multiple thick layers of space. Well, as these layers are hitting these thicker layers, they're bouncing back and they're focused back to the sun. And that's what we're receiving right now. These extra five energy waves are coming back at us from that, coming back to the focal point.
So when Mike from around the world talks about the five waves of energy, and I know you've heard that, and he says it is from Planet X. Now that took me 4 years to get him to confirm that, but he says yes, it is from Planet X, and he talks of Planet X as a binary system. Okay, are we still talking about the same thing, or it's just a different verbiage? What is your take on it?
My information disproves that this is linked to a binary, because it's orbital distance that it goes out, only 360 years, it's not far enough to pick up to circle a secondary sun like a binary star. So its orbit is entirely too short for that as far as the distance.
Okay.
Now, even if it was connected to a sun orbiting a sun and that the sun was coming in, all right, the given path given to us by the Asian astronomers shows us that it's a simple elliptic path. Just like an asteroid or a comet, all right?
Okay.
Otherwise, you'd have like a warped helical path or going around the sun. It would not be a elliptical path. It can't. It wouldn't. So we have just a simple item here. It's a very large comet/planet, if you want to call it that.
Okay.
Because I think it would have to be a whole new category.
Okay.
And it roughly has a 360-year orbit that's very elliptical.
Yeah.
And it crosses Earth's path, an entry and exit, in modern day, it'll be about 152 and 1/8-day separation. And I just find it extremely interesting that this March event that's marked in the calendar matches the data of the Asian. This would be around the time frame that the Asians are pointing at.
Okay. So March.
So we have...
March.
We have multiple lineups here with the text.
Yeah, so March 15th, 16th might be a very, very prophetic time. It could very well be when the very sign wonder in the heavens seen by John, we may actually get to see that in March 15th or 16th. And so I think that's quite fascinating. We're going to be, you know, we're going to be looking up into the constellations, looking up into the sky, see what this is, and see if we see that. And I think, you know, again, this is fascinating information, Gil. It really, really is. And I appreciate the humbleness that Gil Brizard brings to this. He brings a very humbleness. Very few people are willing to just go out and say, look, this is something that's going to happen in the heavens. There's a lot of other pieces and parts moving here on the earth, some current world events. But certainly a lot of these events that have happened are quite extraordinary. What's going on with world powers, wars, rumors of wars, the rise of radical Islam, the election just held in America, the effect of it across the globe with democracies, how close we were to the beast. I mean, Gil, I mean, seriously, I'm telling you, we're still close, but I'm just saying the New World Order was just like on the doorstep, on the threshold here. And I'm not saying it's been pushed back a gazillion years, but there, it's all in prophecy. It's just the timing is all working out. Let me ask you a question here. As when we look at the asteroids, the warped, you're saying asteroids are being warped, and that's why we're seeing more and more asteroids, meteors, fireballs. But what about the pressure from the waves of energy, the pressure affecting earthquakes and volcanoes? What is your take on that?
Well, it's a similar pressure, just like the sun when it pulsates plasma out and it affects us. These waves would have the same effect.
Okay.
Because they're plasma. So it moves our, it starts to collapse our magnetic field, and our magnetic field has, just like a motor, it creates torque in the inner part of our core that causes us to spin. So anything that goes against our magnetic field will cause torquing issues that might cause earthquakes.
Does CERN play any role in this? Does CERN got any effect with anything that's going, especially with the magnetosphere?
I have no idea. I'm not really too concerned about CERN at all. It's in its own little realm. I think that they created CERN to look for a new particle that they could make a weapon to help destroy incoming meteors. Because a nuclear weapon, if you have large meteors, a nuclear weapon is not strong enough.
Wow.
It doesn't have, so they would need something that would have capabilities of something in the magnitudes of thousands of times larger than what a nuclear weapon could do today.
You know, Anthony Patch.
That's what I think they were doing.
Yeah, Anthony Patch said that is definitely part of it, to create a weapon that's even greater than the nuclear power. Now, you do, and I know you know this, but the White House under President Obama last January opened what they call the Armageddon Office. And then in the fall of this past year, an executive order was made by President Obama. And that executive order was to prepare in case of a space weather event that the President of the United States would have full authority and power to confiscate food, water, shelter, bunkers, anything and everything they would need through FEMA and Department of Homeland Security. This was a very broad brush executive order, and he starts talking about a space weather event. So do you think, and then I've heard Vladimir Putin said we should be turning our nukes and rockets and weapons toward the heavens to shoot down incoming asteroids. So are we going to see an increase in asteroid activity, and are we going to see a deep impact?
We've already seen a large increase in asteroids coming in. Will that trend continue? That just depends if there's asteroids in the area that would fulfill that. There's a high probability because the orbits are warped. What used to miss Earth is now crossing Earth's path. And if Earth is in that area when it's crossing, then yes, we're going to have some. Could they be large? Yes. Some of them are very large. Whether or not they will hit us, I can't give any conclusive.
Yeah, and isn't it kind of true that NASA seems to, they have predicted successfully every meteor that has missed us, but they have not ever told us of a meteor that is going to hit us. And can you help me understand that?
Remember when they that meteor that hit us that went over Russia?
Yes.
And they said, oh, it came from the backside of the sun. That's why we couldn't see it. And the public bought that. Well, that's hogwash. Because remember, Earth is spinning around the
sun.
Earth is rotating around the sun. Okay, so 3 months earlier, even we could have seen its orbital path. Remember, a meteor has an elliptical orbit, so it doesn't stay stationary behind the sun like some people say about Planet X. Oh, it's behind it. It's only behind the sun for like a week or so, or at the most. All right.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're going to see it. It's either to the right or to the left, unless it's being cloaked, which I strongly believe that's what our lasers and our space program that Reagan put up there is used for cloaking this. So, yeah. And the Bible alludes, if Jonah's 40-day warning is for us, that means we shouldn't see it before that. It, possibly we might see it for the 40 days if it parallels.
Antarctica, Gil, because we're going to run out of time. Antarctica. We got world leaders going to Antarctica to see something that's very hush-hush. They don't talk about what they're going down there for. I have Steve Quayle as my guest tomorrow, who is, I'm going to ask him, Steve, why in the world are they going to Antarctica? Could Antarctica, as my question to you would be, could Antarctica be an advantage point if you had a high-powered telescope in Antarctica? Is that where, are they going down there to take a peek at Planet X, is my question. Is there a better advantage point it being in the South Pole to maybe spot Planet X?
If money is not an object, then yes, it is the best vantage point because Earth is tilted, okay?
Okay, okay.
And the South Pole region tilts towards the south of the universe. Remember, polar south looking straight down is not south of the universe. That's called nadir. Universal south is pointing towards Sagittarius. Well, you have more nighttime skies, hours on the south side of the poles looking towards the south of the universe. So that would be the ideal vantage point to get the maximum time to look at. And it's also a good place to isolate information because it can't leave there unless you go through through one person at the communication bay to be able to, in other words, it's very easily censored.
So, you have to understand. And so this is a tremendous answer because I've read another article where a man, and I was reading a scientist from the year, I can't remember, seemed like it was the year 2004, who said if a person was in an airplane 35, 36,000 feet in the air and was flying over South America and had a high-powered telescope and the sky was beautifully clear, he might be able to get a peek at Planet X, okay? So I thought to myself, wow. And he said this in 2004. And now I'm thinking, wow, so here we are. It's 2017. We got world leaders going to Antarctica, which is a better location than South America, in an airplane, a stationary base. We know the Nazis built a military base in Antarctica, and in 1947, the United States. This is documented. These are from once were classified documents have been released. 1947, we sent an aircraft carrier down there. We sent destroyers down there to go and try to blow up this Nazi base. And that was 1947. So there's no doubt in my mind there is locations down there and probably a high-powered observatory that has the perfect angle at Planet X. And it might be very possible, and you've answered it, that reason world leaders are slipping off in the middle of the night and going to Antarctica is maybe they're going down there to get a peek at Planet X.
It is a possibility. Put it this way. We have enough points of reference that we're seeing today. Remember, our Bible says that earthquakes would climb so high that it would mimic the pains of a woman giving birth, where it goes into like an exponential growth.
Right.
We're seeing that.
Yeah, we are.
It's quite clear. We're seeing birds die, fish die at extraordinary rates.
Yes, we are.
Our magnetic north is moving at 12 times as north. What affects a magnetic field except another magnetic field? Okay,
That's true.
Planet is affecting our magnetic north. It's even changing our tilt of Earth by 4 degrees.
That's okay, huge.
This is scientific data I'm quoting.
I know
it's not hearsay. All right?
Right.
We have something that is affecting us, the orbits of comets, the orbits of asteroids, our sun, and our planets. And it's inside our solar system. But yet, there is no sighting that's valid right now because the object is cloaked. We have the ability through lasers in space to cloak an object. I show a short video of that on my Planet 7X on YouTube on how that is possible.
Yeah, you're saying to create a cloak, to create a mirage, to hide things that could be seen otherwise, using a deceptive technology, which we do have. The military's had it for quite some time, where they could literally have an army in a field and they could hide them, and the people could sit there and look right at it and don't see them. That technology does exist, and you do a great job showing that in one of your YouTube videos. Folks, check out his website at planet7x.net. That's planet7x.net. Also, you can go to Gilbert Zard's Facebook page.
YouTube.
He's got a, so all of these things are available. Gil, I'm going to have to ask you, you got to come back right before March 15th or 16th or on March 15th or something to give us some kind of idea of what we might be getting ready to see. I'd like to put that invitation out there to you.
Okay, that'd be great. I might be in Jerusalem.
That's all right. Well, if you are, we'll still get you on through Skype. Okay, I'll have Heidi arrange that. So, yes, we would love to get you might have a front row seat on this, and so we'd like to find out what it is. Is the wonder that's in heaven that was spoken of by John the Revelator as he received this, the revelation in Revelation chapter 12. Wow. I mean, this is exciting times. There's no question about it. And Gil, I want to thank you for coming on and being our guest today. I mean, this was really informative. And again, folks, Gil Brizard is the leading expert when it comes to Planet X and how it ties biblically and historically to the events that have been taking place on the Earth. Gil, I appreciate it very much.
Well, thank you, Paul, and thank you, wife Heidi, for the polite emails. And it's a pleasure. I'll see you later.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Gil Brizard, folks, he's a humble man and a very intelligent man who has really brought some really cool stuff forward and some stuff I didn't know, okay? I knew about the Asian documentation that he checked on in Asia, China, Japan, and Korea. And there were events that took place that back in those ancient civilizations, and I'll call it ancient because it was the times of the Bible, let's say, that they saw things in the heavens that happened to be the same dates as events that happened recorded by the Bible, including during the time of Jonah, when Jonah was saying, in 40 days, the Lord is going to destroy the city, okay? And others, like Hezekiah's sundial that went back 10 degrees. There's no way the sun goes back 10 degrees. That's impossible unless there was some type of event in the heavens that would warp the earth or shift the earth or a pole shift of some course. There has to be something. And then when you ask Gil Brizard, well, what in the world could cause that? He would say it'd have to be an unbelievable magnetic pull by another entity, if you will, which could be Planet X. And then when he checks what the Chinese, the Japanese, and the Koreans saw in the heavens, a major event on the exact same time that this was happening in the Middle East with Hezekiah. So these events in the Bible can be explained by other civilizations in their documentation, which only confirms that the Bible's true. It's sort of like an archaeologist finding the Noah's Ark on Mount Ararat. Who's shocked by that? The Bible said it landed in Mount Ararat. But when you find actual proof that, and just like yesterday with Casper, when you find that the Shroud of Turin has DNA in the blood that says the individual only had a mother, a physical mother, but not a physical father. That's impossible unless, and that man that had this blood was crucified. What? Exactly how the Romans crucified people. For the scars on his body, the wounds on his body were the same as in the scriptures. And oh, by the way, the carbon dating dates it back to the time of Christ. So who else do you know went through a crucifixion and rose from the dead and had the DNA only of a mother and not of a physical father? So when we keep finding these things, they all confirm what the Bible said happened. Then it proves to you that this word is true. I don't know what else to say. It proves it's true. And the Lord said that my word, he said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word abideth forever. And we may not understand it, but it's still true anyway. Even if we may not believe it, but it's still true anyway. And odds are we don't understand it. There's parts, there's no doubt in my mind that we don't have the exact full understanding of the timing of the coming of Christ. No way. Matter of fact, nobody knows the day nor the hour that the Son of Man, not the angels in heaven, not the Son, but the Father only. But you can see the day approaching. And look at the current events going on around the world. Certainly, you know you're in the last days. There's 2,000 people or so over 2,000 have been at YouTube today. And over 1,000 at New Livestream, and plus all the rest of those of you at our website and everywhere else and Blog Talk. But I'm going to ask you a question, and we'll have Steve Quayle on tomorrow. But That's if we're still here tomorrow. That's if you're still alive tomorrow. But my question to you is, are you ready to meet the Lord? If he comes at the midnight hour, which if he comes when you least expect it, which he said he'd do, if he comes like a thief in the night, which he said he will, are you ready? For the Bible says to watch and pray, for an hour you think not the Son of Man cometh. Are you ready to meet the Lord? Have you given your life to Jesus Christ? Have you been washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul, cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Now lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the souls unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul, cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? This is the Salvation Station, and it's reaching out through the power of the Holy Ghost to you right now. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world. No, we've got enough condemnation coming at us the way it is. We got enough people judging us the way it is. We got enough people putting us down the way it is. We didn't need God to put us down any further. He's come to lift us up. He's come to break the chains. He's come to set us free. And he used his Son, Jesus Christ, to break every chain. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to receive that blessed hope, that glorious, there's that song by Casting Crowns about that glorious day. All right? And you can be, look, I'm not worried about the end of time. Some people say, man, are you freaking out? No, I'm looking forward to it. I'm lifting up my head. I'm looking up. I'm saying, you know what? Look, I like to live on this planet just like anybody else. I love my life. I love God's way of living. I just love being alive. I love my family. I love my wife, Heidi. I love my parents. I love my siblings. I love my body of Christ, brothers and sisters in Christ. I love seeing people come to Jesus. I love baptizing folks. I love it all. But I'm telling you right now, when the King comes, I'm ready to go. I'm not going to ask questions. I'm taking the bus, Gus. I'm not going to discuss much. All right? Are you serious? So it's time to give your life to Jesus Christ. And so I'm going to play a song right now. If you have enough confidence, enough patience, just enough to pray. Just pray just a moment. And let's get saved. Okay? Seriously. I don't want to drive another nail. Just think about this. Don't drive another nail into the cross. Don't let sin in your life cost you your soul. Jesus has come to set you free, and it is time to let Christ into your life. Just type in the chat room, I want to be saved. I'll write your name down right now. I don't want to drive another nail.
Sam was a carpenter of 50 years. Pounded out blood, sweat, and tears. One day he hung his hammer up. He wanted to do the things he loved. What once was Sunday fishing.
William wants to be saved. God bless you, William.
Told his wife to find me.
I'll be down at the creek. Brian wants to be saved.
Cause I don't want to drive another nail. I worked hard to do my job and I did it well. I've got the scars on these two hands that show I haven't failed.
Sharon wants to be saved. There's others. Church, pray a moment. There's people whose life is hanging in the balance. Their soul is in the balance. Yes, his name is Brian Rooley. You can do this right now.
Easter Sunday rolled around in a country church for the lost and found.
Brian Rooley and Sharon Shanice and Denny and Linda.
As the preacher spoke on Calvary's.
And Dan wants to be saved. Praise God. And Karen wants to be saved.
You could hear old Sam crying as he fell down on his knees.
Time's running out.
I don't want to drive another man.
And Karn.
I want to live my life for you. I want to.
And Skyfly.
You've got the stars on your two hands that show where I have faith.
And Dom.
Lord, I don't want to drive.
Drive another nail. And Billy. Billy, shoot.
I want to live my life for you. I want to do it well.
And many are rededicating and repenting and reaffirming. Thank you, Michelle. And Georgia. Georgina. And Mike. Jesus Christ. His name is Mike Marks. Mike Marks. Folks, right now we know that William and Brian Rooley and Sharon Shanice and Denny and Linda and Dan and Karen and Skyfly and Karn and Dom and Billy Schuth and Georgina and Mike Marks and Logic from the UK all want to be saved. And we're going to pray with anyone. Many people are rededicating. Many are reaffirming me. Some of them are repenting. A lot of folks saying, you know what? Deb wants to be saved also. God bless you, Deb. Look, the Bible says, whosoever calleth upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And this is your hour. This is your moment. This is the day the Lord has made. He said, let's rejoice, be glad there is. It's time to get saved. I'm going to play this song one more time. Don't wait. Don't drive another nail. Don't put the Lord off, folks. Time is running out. I'm telling you. I don't know when he's coming. I don't even know if we got to March 15th. I don't know what. He's coming. In an hour, you think not, he's coming.
Sam was a carpenter, 50.
Anthony Roy. Jimmy Carl.
Pounded out blood, sweat, and tears. One day, hung his hammer up. He wanted to do the things he loved.
Anthony.
Once was Sunday fishing out 7 days.
Anthony's last name is Roy.
Told his wife to find me.
I'll be down at the creek. God bless you, Anthony Roy.
Cause I don't want to drive another nail.
Somebody needs to get saved over YouTube. That's you're sitting there and the devil's trying to talk you out of this. You need to type, I want to be saved. You need to get right with God today. I don't know how much time you got. And there's people watching me on new live stream. There's people listening on Blog Talk. You don't know. You don't even have a clue. None of us. We're a heartbeat away. How long are we going to play around? Prince wants to be saved. How long are we going to miss the blessings in our lives? How long are you going to stumble in the darkness? It's time to get saved. Mikati wants to be saved.
In a country church.
God bless you, Mekati. Ezekiel wants to be saved. Praise God.
Sam was there against his will.
Praise God. They're coming to Jesus today.
Spoke,
Tony Martin from Ireland wants to be saved.
Of how they took the master and they led him to a tree. You could hear old Sam crying as he fell down on his knees.
Jason West wants to be saved.
I don't want to drive.
Praise God.
I want to live my life for you. I want to do it.
Chris Howell, we pray with Chris a lot. We know he's just reaffirming. Praise God. We love him and his family.
Lord, I don't want to drive another nail. I don't want to drive another nail. I want to live my life for you. I want to do it well. You've got the scars on your two hands that show where I have failed. I don't want to drive another nail.
Ralph S. wants to be saved. Praise God. Sandy Williams wants to be saved. Praise God. Praise God. Just one more. Just Robert wants to be. Robert Reith wants to be saved. I'm just going to kick it back just one more minute of that song. Just one more minute of that song.
Oh, how they took the master and nailed him to a tree. You could hear old Sam cry.
And Susan Kelm.
Fell down on his knees.
You're making the right decision right here, right now. Somebody's getting saved right now.
I wanna drive another nail.
And Robert.
I wanna live my life for you.
We got him.
I wanna do it.
And Richard.
You've got the scars on your two hands. I'm sure where
I have failed. Lord, I don't wanna drive another nail. I don't want to drive another nail. Yes, Richard V.
I want to live my life for you. I want to do it well. You've got the scars on your two hands that show where I have failed. Lord, I don't want to drive another nail.
Oh, yes. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's not in ourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. William and Brian Rooley and Sharon Chanez and Denny and Linda and Dan and Karen and Skyfly and Karn and Dom and Billy Shuth and Georgina and Mike Marks and Logic at the United Kingdom and Deb and Anthony Roy and Jimmy Carl and Prince and Mekati and Ezekiel and Tony Martin in Ireland and Jason West and Ralph S. and Sandy Williams and Robert Reith and Susan Kelm and Richard V. all want to be saved right here, right now that we know of. And we know there's others watching at publiclyprophecy.com. We know there's people listening on Blog Talk Radio. We know people have got their cell phones and iPhones and they have no way to type. There's people watching us on Roku satellite television, and there's thousands of people watching us on the archives right now, whether it be at New Live Stream or at YouTube Live. There are people who know right now they want to be saved. You pray with me as I pray with all these folks, and let's get right with God today, because God's mercy and grace is flowing right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to be saved, and I want to get my life right with you. I want to be born into the kingdom of God. I want my name written in the Lamb's book of life. I don't want to be left behind. I don't want to miss heaven. I don't want to be lost in eternity in the damnation of hell. I do not want my life to be ruined and my soul to be destroyed. And so I'm repenting today. I'm believing in Jesus. I'm coming to the salvation station today, seeking for answers, looking for truth. And I found it in Jesus Christ. So I repent and I confess my sins and I open my heart, Lord. Please forgive me because I believe. I believe. I believe. I believe. I believe. I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. I believe that he rose from the dead. I believe that he's the Son of God. I see a Kakia from Slovenia. I see a Giac 2545. I believe that he gave his life on the cross for my sins. I believe that he rose from the dead. I believe that he ascended into heaven. And I believe that he's coming back again soon and very soon. And so right here, right now, by faith in God's grace, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost, in Jesus' name, I am saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm healed and delivered and set free and born again, saved in Jesus' precious name. Somebody shout amen right now. Praise God. The angels are rejoicing in heaven as people have been born into the kingdom of God. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Welcome to the family. All right, welcome to the family, every one of you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29 that we know of. Welcome to the family. 29 different IP addresses, 29 different individuals that we know of. Jesus knows exactly who you are. And the Bible says, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I'm praying that the power of the Holy Ghost gets a hold of you. I'm praying that you receive the baptism of fire. Because I'm telling you, folks, we're going into a time like never before. Welcome to the family. Your names have been written. Lamb's Book of Life. And they're shouting. And somebody better start building some mansions. Get a new building project going in heaven. And if there is an RU Series Boulevard, well, I want to meet you there. All right? Praise God. Daryl is the man's name, who is Logic of UK. Thank you so much, Timothy. You know what, folks? We got people getting saved in Slovenia, in Ireland, in the United Kingdom. I'm going to just tell you right now. God is setting the captives free. Salvation Station, our brand new studio that we're going to build down in the blessed Begley Bunker, truly is going to be a location to reach out, to expand in the gospel, and to raise the level of excellence of the message of Jesus Christ. Now, let me just say now, wow, are you serious? This morning, prayer cloths, blankets, Bibles, chemo caps. I'm going to tell you, there's so many people sick out there, you wouldn't even believe how many people are sick, how many anointed prayer cloths. We are sending blankets today to 11 different nations. I'm talking just the blankets alone, not counting the Bibles, not counting the prayer cloths. 11 different nations, several in the United Kingdom, some in Canada, a couple of them in Africa. I know one in New Zealand. I think there was one or two in Australia. And not cheap. It's not cheap to take a blanket, put it in a box, and send it to the other parts of the world. But we can do it. And, you know, I was just saying this morning, I said, you know, God is reaching and saving, and miracles are happening. Thank you. The Salvation Station's a real thing here, folks. It's a real deal. This is the real deal. It's about changing lives. It's about not just only getting people saved, but getting people encouraged, getting people informed, getting people healed. In Jesus' name. Thank you. Thank you. As you give right now, please. And I mean, as you give right now, please do it. Let the Lord speak to your heart. And remember, March the 1st, we're going to take up a special day. That's a special day. That day, I'm calling on every person that ever listens to our radio programs or live programs or ever watch a YouTube video. I'll be calling on YouTube. I'll be pounding on their doors. This is the one day I need every one of them to give their best they can give so we can finish this project without... completely finished in Jesus' name. Thank you for giving today. As you give, hit that easy button, as Billy Knight Train would say. But let me just say to the people who got saved, God bless you. Welcome to the family of God. I mean, you got some brothers and sisters in Christ all over the world now. That's okay. And your names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the angels are shouting all over the world. I mean, heaven, excuse me. And maybe all over the world, wherever the angels are. I want to encourage you to be baptized, to find a pastor, to find a church somewhere in the community where you live, okay? And just walk in and say, look, I got saved, man. I got radically saved. And I want to be baptized in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, if you want to come to Indiana, why don't you come to South Bend, Indiana? You talk about a conference. We're going to have Dr. Lester Summerall's home church, beautiful facility, South Bend, Indiana, coming up March 18 and 19. Saturday morning from 9 to noon. And Sunday morning at 10:30, I think. I'll be preaching both of these services, and it will be a powerful, powerful start our year of preaching in different locations across the country and around the world. Now, if you want to be baptized, come the next weekend to Knox, Indiana, and we'll be baptized with 3 days of glory, March 24th, 25th, and 26th. That's March 24th, 25th, and 26th. At Community Gospel Baptist Church, that's Community Gospel Baptist Church in Knox, Indiana. 3 days of glory, and it truly will be just that. Also, if you want to get baptized in Dallas, Texas, I'll be at the Hear the Watchman Conference coming up March 31st April 1st, April 2nd, down in Dallas. And 19 speakers are going to be speaking there. And I'm the last one. I got the Sunday morning service. That's why I'll take it. All right. Praise God. And when the service is, what a time we're going to have, too. Are you serious? And then the baptism, praise and worship is going to be powerful there. Baptism right after that service. What a way to conclude a tremendous weekend of some of the greatest speakers on end time prophetic biblical prophecy there is on the planet gathering in Dallas, Texas. It's going to be a great, great weekend. Hearthewatchman.org. Just go to www.hearthewatchman.org. If you need to get registered for South Bend, go to the contact. Is that where you go? Go to the, hit on my website, click contact, scroll down, and get registered on the, and just register and let us know you're coming. It's free. It's a free conference. All right. If you're coming to 3 Days of Glory in Knox, Indiana, go get registered. Let us know you're coming, because last time we checked, we had 190 people scheduled, and there's more. And we're trying to make sure we got breakfast covered, because if you come from out of town, we give you free breakfast and fellowship, and we're just trying to make sure we can handle it. It's, praise God, what a problem. And then if you're coming to Dallas, Texas, you got to go to hearthewatchman.org. That's hearthewatchman.org. Now there, I think that there's a cost for that conference, because there's 19 speakers. You got to have enough income to cover this conference. The you'll need to give whatever that is. But if you type Begley, you get a discount. Okay, so type Begley, you get a discount. All right, I want you to do that. And praise God. If you're giving today, please hit the easy button right now. And thank God, you folks have been just unbelievable. But I need you today to help me here. I'm getting ready to, wow. Just hit the easy button, okay, in Jesus' name. And also, if you want to write me, please write me it. And we got a new mailing address. The old one still works, but here's the new one. It's Paul Begley Prophecy. This Paul Begley Prophecy, 1048 Sagamore Parkway. That's 1048 Sagamore Parkway. Box 33. That's box 33. West Lafayette, Indiana. West Lafayette, Indiana, 47906. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. And the Lord will bless you. Watch and see if God won't bless you. You can't outgive God. I double dog dare you to try, because He loves you so much. He will supply every need. He's the God of more than enough. He can do exceedingly abundantly greater than you ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. When you write me, please put a check or money order in there. But would you give me your testimony, or praise report, a prayer request? Same thing if you're hitting the easy button right now on my website. If you're hitting it and you're giving, put a little note up there, okay? Something that we can pray about, something you want to give us a praise report, let us know what God is doing in your life and what you want us to pray about as well, okay? Praise God. Are you serious? How many enjoyed Gil Brizard today? I think that was the best I've ever heard. I think that was the best interview ever of Gil Brizard. I'm just going to just go ahead and go on a limb and say it. I think that might have been the best interview anybody's ever done with Gil Brizard. It was very, very clear, very precise. He was very excellent in his communication to us. He broke it down. He knew how simple a man I am, and he made it easier for all of us to understand. And so we just praise God for him. Tomorrow, Steve Quayle. What? Steve Quayle will be our guest tomorrow, and we're going to be asking him about Antarctica and why is all these leaders going down there. You heard Gil say, yes, it's possible that if you went to the South Pole and had a telescope, that would be the best view of the incoming planet 7X. But we're going to ask Steve Quayle, why are all the world leaders going down there? And also many other things we're going to find out from Steve Quayle tomorrow. Okay, don't miss the broadcast. It starts at 12 noon Eastern, as always. Praise God. Then Mike from around the world will gather with us on Friday from COT, the Worldwide Network. We look forward to being with Mike always and get an update on the 5 waves of energy. And you just heard Gil say that the waves of energy are definitely, the asteroids are being warped, the planet's under pressure. All these things are certainly coming to pass. We're in the last days. Are you serious? God bless all of you. We love you all. We really do. Keep looking up, folks. When I say that, I mean it. Keep looking up, because our redemption is drawing nigh. For some reason, I'm having some problems here, but I'll fix it. Say, Paul, you always have problems with those buttons. God bless all of you. We love you guys. Thank you to all the moderators and everybody else out there.
Fourth generational preacher, Pastor Paul Begley, thanks you for your participation in today's broadcast. The Coming Apocalypse with Pastor Paul Bagley is broadcast Monday through Friday for 3 full hours from noon till 3 Eastern Standard Time. You're also encouraged to watch Pastor Paul Bagley with Sunday Night Live from 7 p.m. till 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Keep praying!
Stop there. Pastor Paul preaches the good word of salvation daily with his highly popular YouTube video ministry, examining today's headlines and showing how biblical prophecy is unfolding before our very eyes.
Are you serious?
Whether it's in the chat room during the coming apocalypse or with his YouTube videos, Pastor Bagley is watching for the five magic
Salvation
words
Station!
And they are, I want to be saved. I want to be saved.
29 today. 29 that we know of.
Pastor Paul will give you his full attention and lead you to salvation through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you again for your continued support of Pastor Paul Bagley and his internet ministry. Your love, gifts, and show of support help him to keep moving forward in the Lord's work. Again, thank you for watching, listening, and encouraging each other. And until next time, Pastor Paul says...
Are you serious? Are you serious? God bless you guys. Are you serious?
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
All right, and so all of you at YouTube, God bless you. Wow, what a great crowd we had in there today. I don't know, that's somewhere close to 2,200 people, 2,100 people, whatever it was. So that's at any one high point. That's probably at the highest peak, but still, lots of folks come drifting in and out during this two-hour broadcast. Still got 800 of you there, and we're supposed to be over. Anyway, it was a great crowd. You guys were awesome today, and keep telling others. Let's get them here so they can hear about the end times. What's going on, and just how close we are to the coming of the Lord. God bless you guys. Thank you guys for being there. We love you, and we'll see you tomorrow on the coming apocalypse. Check out my YouTube videos. Wow, are you serious?
Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye not be troubled, for all these things must come to pass. But the end is not yet, for nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Welcome to the Coming Apocalypse, analysis of today's headlines, and how Bible prophecy is unfolding before your very eyes. Please welcome now your host, Pastor Paul Bagley.
Well, thank you very much, Lee. Welcome, everyone. This is the Coming Apocalypse. I'm Pastor Paul Bagley, and I have nuts. Well, I tell you, first of all, I was censored all morning by YouTube and would not let it would say that I had posted a video 3 times, but it would not allow it to post, okay, until I changed the title. I had to remove the word urgent. Once I removed the word urgent, it has to do with this asteroid that everybody's talking about. This asteroid WWF9 that NASA once had on the screen and then removed it. And so there's people who, you know, there's all kinds of theories out there that this thing is going to get very close to the Earth on February 25th. I don't know. I'm going to ask Gil Brizard. It's one of the questions I'm going to ask Gil Brizard. And that's right. Gil Brizard is our guest today. So we're going to ask him. We have 4 serious questions. I'll tell you about that in a minute. But we've got a prophecy alert. Anyway, YouTube was allowing me to post my other videos, but would not let me post this video until I changed the headline. It never said that's what the problem was. It just wouldn't. Once I changed the headline, it posted. Blog Talk Radio gave me fits till the last 5 seconds, and then it finally said I could start the show. So I think Gil Brizard's appearance is certainly being monitored. There's no doubt about it. And so whatever he's got to say, matter of fact, he says he has breaking news for us, or a breaking revelation for us that he's going to share with us today. We're going to talk to him about 4 things. Planet 7X. We want an update on it. The comet 45P. The asteroid WF9. Is it really an asteroid? Is it really going to go by February 25th, or is that just just a rumor out there? And we want to ask him about the revelation, the wonder in heaven that's found in Revelation chapter 12. What is his take on that coming into alignment What is his take on that in September? And then he has a special breaking revelation he wants to share with us that's going to take place this spring. And so we'll find out what that is when Gil Brizard joins us. But before we get anywhere else, let's go to the Word of the Lord. We're going to go to the book of Numbers, and we're actually going to go to chapter 19. This has to do with a prophecy alert taking place today on breaking news that a red heifer has been discovered in a dairy farm in Mexico. I've seen the picture of it. It is absolutely perfect. And it was not DNA manipulated to make it. It is born naturally, and it has no spot, no blemish, and is a perfect red heifer, which the Bible requires when dedicating the temple. Okay? And so, of course, with the talk with the third temple coming, this is incredible information. We're going to wait and see. They've already found one red heifer, you know, over in northeastern portion of America. But the heifer has to be at a certain age. And once that age passes, then you got to find another one. Okay? They have found one. It qualifies. It's in Mexico. We'll tell you more about that in just a moment. But right now, Max will read from the King James Version of the Bible. He will read Numbers chapter 19. Max?
Numbers 19. And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, This is the ordinance of the law which the Lord hath commanded, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring thee a red heifer without spot, wherein is no blemish, and upon which never came a yoke. And ye shall give her unto Eleazar the priest, that he may bring her forth without the camp, and one shall slay her before his face. And Eleazar the priest shall take of her blood with his finger, and sprinkle of her blood directly before the tabernacle of the congregation seven times. And one shall burn the heifer in his sight, her skin and her flesh and her blood, with her dung shall he burn. And the priest shall take cedar wood and hyssop and scarlet, and cast it into the midst of the burning of the heifer. Then the priest shall wash his clothes, and he shall bathe his flesh in water, and afterward he shall come into the camp, and the priest shall be unclean until the even. And he that burneth her shall wash his clothes in water, and bathe his flesh in water, and shall be unclean until the even. And the man that is clean shall gather up the ashes of the heifer, and lay them up without the camp in a clean place. It shall be kept for the congregation of the children of Israel for a water of separation. It is a purification for sin. And he that gathereth the ashes of the heifer shall wash his clothes, and be unclean until the even. And it shall be unto the children of Israel, and unto the stranger that sojourneth among them, for a statute for ever. He that toucheth the dead body of any man shall be unclean 7 days. He shall purify himself with it on the third day, and on the seventh day he shall be clean. But if he purify not himself the third day, then the seventh day he shall not be clean.
Huge!
Whosoever toucheth the dead body of any...
Time out! I mean, this. I know this is Old Testament. I know it's the book of Numbers. But the significance of the date. If a man touches a dead body, he is unclean for 7 days. But he must be clean, purify himself on the third day. Then on the seventh day, he shall be clean, basically, okay? But if he does not purify himself on the third day, then on the seventh day, he won't be clean. Now, folks, we know if you read the Bible, and I've said this many times, you guys, that the third day, if you read the Bible throughout the entire Bible, unbelievable stuff always would happen on the third day. It's in all over the Bible. We know for sure that Yeshua, that Jesus Christ, rose from the dead on the third day. That was the purification. So this is a shadow of things to come, just so you'll know that Christ rose from the dead on the third day, so that all of us who raise in Christ in the end time on the seventh day, which is God's final day. Remember, Peter said, remember, be not ignorant of this one thing. One day is with the Lord 1,000 years, and 1,000 years one day. Okay, remember that? So in other words, there are 7 pure days with God. There's really 7 days with God. We are in the closing of the sixth day. We've lost some time with the calendars that because we kept changing calendars, jumping around. The Hebrew calendar says this is the year 5777, okay? And of course, there's other calendars, different years. But at the bottom line is this, we are somewhere very close to the closing of a sixth day for humanity and the beginning of a seventh day, which would be the seventh day being the seventh millennium of time. So God is saying, you got to be born again. You've got to come clean through the third day resurrection of Christ so that you'll be found worthy in the seventh day or the day of resurrection for mankind. All right? You got to be saved. If you're not saved, you will not raise in the likeness of Christ. You will not be a part of the first resurrection. For the Bible says, for the second death have no power over you. So this is an important thing that's going on here. Because God is actually signifying that the dedication of the temple is and the ritual and the blood sacrifice and the red heifer and the purification and the baptisms going on here of the washing, all of these things in the Old Testament was bringing us to the revelation of the New Testament taking place right now. And we know that they're going to build the third temple, which is a prophetic fulfillment in the Bible of the end times. And so here we are on the brink of this thing, just unbelievably on the brink of this thing. Are you serious? We're on the edge of eternity. We're at the brink of the beast. We're at the prophetic time like never before. We're at the apocalyptic hour. Incredible stuff here. What? And you'll never hear, you rarely hear this taught or preached on because folks will sometimes get emotional about it. But it's not hard for me to understand it. God put a plan in motion, and he's fulfilling it perfectly. And if you study the Old Testament, it can help you understand the New. And it's all about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's all about the Lord's return for the bride. It's really setting us up. And folks, these things are unbelievable. We're dealing with red heifers being born that are perfect. This one here, I've seen the picture of it. Perfect. Not one hair a different color. Not one blemish on this heifer. Perfect. And it can never have a yoke put on it, okay? Can never have been trained by man at all. It has to be a pure DNA perfected heifer. And that was what was required in Exodus for the dedication of the temple. And obviously, so if you're hearing about the temple mount, the all of the utensils are already in place, ready to go. The temple's already prefab, ready to be brought in. I mean, the negotiations are going on. The nations are gathering around Jerusalem. I mean, you'd have to be absolutely spiritually blind to not understand you're living in the last days. Now, we don't know the day nor the hour, but my Lord have mercy. We're in the fig tree generation. Listen to this. Israel was not a nation rebirthed as a nation until 1948. Unbelievable here. It's here. Oh, by the way, from the covenant of Abraham to the crucifixion of Christ, 1948 years. And from the crucifixion of Christ until Israel rebirthed as a nation, 1948. And it's been a nation coming up on the 69th anniversary, which Trump may make the declaration he's moving the U.S. Embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem on May 14th or somewhere in late May. That ain't the day he'll move it, but he may make the proclamation he's moving it, which is unreal because it's at the 69th, end of the 69th year. And if you go to Daniel and read about the 69 weeks, then you have the 7 days left or the 1 week left or the 1 year left if you look at it from this perspective, from Daniel's vision. So all the pieces and parts, you can't make this stuff up. You can't have these many pieces and parts prophetically coming together at the same exact time. It's just absolutely mathematically impossible unless God is orchestrating it. And I've been preaching the gospel for 33 years, coming up on my 33rd year, which I got to say something that's very prophetic about this year. Can I just say, are you ready to be blessed? The Lord reminded me this morning. He said, you do know what this is, don't you? And I said, well, what do you mean, Lord? What are you saying? What? You are in your 33rd year preaching the gospel. Christ died at age 33. Your new address that you just moved, you moved your mailing address, is Paul Begley Prophecy, 1048 Sagamore Parkway. That's Paul Begley Prophecy, 1048 Sagamore Parkway, Box 33. What? West Lafayette, Indiana. 47906. So the Lord says to me, you're in your 33rd year of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you're in your 7th year online. You're going to celebrate your 7th year on March 1st. And you're going to celebrate your 33rd year anniversary of preaching the gospel on June 24th. And it's happening in the same year. So them saying, are you serious? God saying, do you think these things are by accident? When I told you to get a cup of coffee and turn the camera on and look into the camera and visualize at least 1,000 people would be watching you live online. At the time, folks, can I say to you, there was no live stream. YouTube did not even have live stream capability either. But the Lord gave me a word and said, look into the camera and visualize at least 1,000 people watching you live and speak to that. And I knew I was doing videos, but that was the word he gave me. It wasn't just now, it's just in the last 2 years that YouTube has had live capability. And the crowds of folks listening today will be way over 1,000. So every prophetic thing that God speaks, there's 1,098 already at YouTube now. Right now, we've already got the show. Gil Brazard is going to join us today. Steve Quayle will join us tomorrow. Mike from around the world will join us on Friday. We're going to try to get some answers to some explanations to the unknown. But first, go back to the heifer. I got to get back to the heifer. I mean, are you serious? Are you serious? Max, are you serious?
And that is dead and purifieth not himself, defileth the tabernacle of the Lord, and that soul shall be cut off from Israel, because the water of separation was not sprinkled upon him. He shall be unclean, his uncleanness is yet upon him. This is the law when a man dieth in a tent. All that come into the tent, and all that is in the tent, shall be unclean 7 days. And every open vessel which hath no covering bound upon it is unclean. And whosoever toucheth one that is slain with a sword in the open fields, or a dead body, or a bone of a man, or a grave, shall be unclean 7 days. And for an unclean person, they shall take of the ashes of the burnt heifer, of purification for sin, and running water shall be put thereto in a vessel.
Unbelievable.
And a clean person shall take hyssop, and dip it in the water, and sprinkle it upon the tent, and upon all the vessels, and upon the persons that were there, and upon him that touched a bone, or one slain, or one dead, or a grave. And the clean person shall sprinkle upon the unclean on the third day, and on the seventh day. And on the seventh day he shall purify himself and wash his clothes, and bathe himself in water,
right,
and shall be clean at even. But the man that shall be unclean, and shall not purify himself, that soul shall be cut off from among the congregation.
What?
Because he hath defiled the sanctuary of the Lord. The water of separation hath not been sprinkled upon him. He is unclean. And it shall be a perpetual statute unto them, that he that sprinkleth the water of separation shall wash his clothes, and he that toucheth the water of separation shall be unclean until even. And whatsoever the unclean person toucheth shall be unclean, and the soul that toucheth it shall be unclean until even.
All right, now, so God had a specific, absolute plan that must be carried out extraordinarily accurately. And that was to bring us to the pure DNA of Jesus Christ. We know this, okay? The cleansing, all of this leading us to eventually the virgin giving birth to the man-child. Man in flesh, God divine, the Son of the living God, in a barn, in the back parts of Bethlehem came this baby to set humanity free from sin. All of it coming together in the prophetic plan of God. Now, let's take a look. Hang with me, okay? Gilbert Zard's going to be here in a minute. Hold that thought a moment. We'll talk about the heifer in just a second. But let me tell you some other things that are going on around the world. As far as the earthquakes are concerned, yes, we have earthquakes. And let's just check them out the last 24 hours. 4.6 Japan, 3.2 Alaska, 4.4 Russia, 3.0 Oklahoma, 2.6 Puerto Rico, 3.9 Chile, 2.7 Puerto Rico, 4.7 Japan, 4.8 Ecuador, 4.7 Colombia, 3.5 British Virgin Islands, 2.6 Alaska, 2.6 both in Hawaii, a 2.8 in Nevada, 2.8 Alaska, 2.7 Alaska, 5.1 earthquake in China, 4.9 New Zealand, 4.6 Peru, 2.9 Alaska, 4.4 Chile, 4.6 Peru, 3.3 Alaska, 2.6 Hawaii, 4.5 Tonga, 2.5 Cobb, California. That is the last 24 hours, the earthquake report, nothing major, with lots of pressure being applied to the Earth right here, right now. I can tell you that the Earth is under severe stress because the solar winds that are coming off the sun are at 600. They're still, yesterday they were 736,000 kilometers per second. Today they're 682,000 kilometers per second with a gaping hole on the sun, a coronal hole in the sun's atmosphere, which is allowing a solar stream that's putting tons of pressure. The only thing I can figure right now is that full pressure from that hasn't completely reached the Earth yet, because if it had, I would think there would have been a major quake. Hopefully, when it does, if there's it hits in a spot where it's not as weak or not one of the weak spots, or that it that the none of the tectonic plates are about ready to go. Let's hope not. We know the Earth is just like so fragile right now. It's so fragile, but it is incredible what's going on right now around the world in many, many different avenues. Gil Brazard, a very articulate astronomer, and nobody has studied Planet X and tied it to biblical, the historical accounts of major events that happened on the Earth in the Bible, and then checked it with ancient historical facts of events that happened to the Earth, and they matched one event after another. No one has really studied it any more than Gil Brazard. Now, some people, you know, just like a lot of folks, they attack people. Gil Brazard said by his best calculations, he really thought that Planet 7X, he calls it Planet 7X or Planet X, would have been in a full arrival and full impact on the Earth last year, March 26, 2016. He really felt that. But he said from the very beginning, but I don't know. I'm giving it an 8-year window somewhere between 2013 and 2021. And the reason he's doing that is because historically and biblically, every time there was a major event, he calculated how long each time these events happened, and he took that and applied that same analogy to this event since the last one we've had. And it would have been landing somewhere in this 8-year period. So because of that, he continues to keep a close eye on the heavens. He continues to keep looking up, and he continues to wait to see what is going to develop, just like all the rest of us, okay? Now, quickly, grab some coffee.